Hello everyone, thank you for joining in and welcome to this exclusive webinar on NABARD Grade A 2021 by ELITA faculty members. So today I have with me your expert faculty members, VD sir, then Narveer sir I have with me, Avinash sir is here, Veena ma'am is here. So guys, and myself of course, Ritika, so I will be taking up and we all will be taking up your strategies, right? The exam NABARD Grade A is expected. The notification is actually expected in the month of June. We are expecting the exam will take place in July, right? So this is the right time to prepare for the examination. I hope you have been preparing, right? So why this seminar? What is the objective of this seminar? So guys, I will just show you one thing. So guys, see, these are the results by EduTap in past few years. You can see that EduTap has been able to produce the maximum results in few years, right? Now, why are we able to do this? How are we able to do this? How do we guide our students that they are able to get selected in the examination? We are humbled to announce this, okay? But we want to share with you the right strategy. We want you to decode the examination. What are the examination patterns, what is the trend of the examination, and how you should approach the exam to clear it, that we are going to today discuss with you. So the idea behind this session is to not only decode the examination for you, but also to tell you the right pinpointed strategy, which has been, of course, devised on the years of experience of our faculty members and the toppers, of course. So guys, I'll first start with the pattern of the examination. First of all, I hope many of you are going to appear in the examination for the very first time. So this is very crucial to know that what are the phases of the examination before we can start, right? So this exam is conducted in three phases. You can see it's phase one, phase two, phase three, right? So phase one, till now, till the year 2020, this has been the pattern of the examination. There are seven subjects in phase one: reasoning, English, computer knowledge, general awareness, quant, aptitude, ESIs, as you can see, economic social issues with focus on rural India, and ARD. So very important thing I want to tell you, ESI, ARD, and your English are of 40 marks out of these seven subjects, and rest are of 20 marks. Cumulative marks are 200 out of these seven subjects. So total marks 200, negative marking 0.25, composite time is of 120 minutes, 2 hours you have to clear this examination, right? There is cutoff sectional as well as overall. So that means you have to clear the section-wise cutoff also. But guys, phase one marks are not added in final score. This you have to understand. You just clear the phase one to appear in phase two. Those marks are going to be counted in your final selection, right? Guys, you can type your queries in the chat box. We will be taking up your queries in the session, in the end of the session, in the middle also. And of course, we have a surprise for you also. You have joined on this webinar, so we will be telling you about that surprise in the end, right? So coming to the next phase of the examination, phase two. So my dear friends, there are two papers in phase two: general English descriptive paper worth 100 marks, ESI and ARD combined paper. It is objective type, 100 marks. So general English is a descriptive type paper. You have to write the paper in the, through computer interface. While ESI and ARD is of MCQs type paper. 200 marks are there in this paper. 1/4 negative marking, and of course, each paper 90 minutes. So this is the basic idea you have to know if you are going to appear in the examination. Now interview guys, phase three, very important. 25 marks for interview. These marks and your phase two marks are added, and the final list is based on the score attained by the candidates in these two examinations. So 225 are your final marks, right? So knowing this guys, in this particular session today, we are going to discuss with you the right strategy for phase one. Then we will go to phase two, right? ESI, ARD are the common subjects in phase one, phase two. So we will be handling them together. And finally, English descriptive as well. Right. So guys, now I will request VD sir, your quant and reasoning faculty, to take up this strategy session for this particular phase one exam. Over to you, VD sir.
हेलो फ्रेंड्स, कैसे हैं आप सभी। मैं उम्मीद करता हूं कि इस महामारी के टाइम पे आप सभी अच्छे होंगे और आप सभी मुझे सुन पा रहे होंगे। तो आज के सेशन का हमारा एजेंडा रहेगा कि क्वांट और रीजनिंग की जो हमारी स्ट्रेटेजी है वो क्या होनी चाहिए नाबार्ड ग्रेड ए 2021 के एग्जाम के रिगार्डिंग। तो मैं आपको पूरा बताऊंगा कि क्या हमारा पैटर्न होता है इस एग्जाम का, और साथ में चर्चा करेंगे कि क्या सिलेबस रहेगा और इसकी तैयारी हमें किस तरीके से आगे बढ़ानी है। तो चलिए फिर शुरू करते हैं। तो मैं आपके साथ स्क्रीन शेयर करना चाहूंगा जिसमें मैं आपको फुल ऑन बताऊंगा कि किस तरीके से हमें अपनी तैयारी को आगे बढ़ाना है। तो सबसे पहले हम लोग चर्चा करेंगे स्ट्रेटेजी फॉर क्वांट की, क्वांट के लिए हमारी स्ट्रेटेजी क्या होनी चाहिए। ठीक है बच्चे, तो सबसे पहले हम लोग यहाँ पे जो बात करेंगे वो सेक्शनल कट ऑफ की बात करेंगे, और वो भी ईयर वाइज। ये बताना क्यों जरूरी है, क्योंकि बहुत सारे बच्चों का देखो एक सवाल होता है कि सर मेरे दूसरे जो सेक्शन है वो बहुत अच्छे हैं, बट अगर क्वांट और रीजनिंग को मैं जस्ट क्वालिफाई भी कर जाऊं, ऐसा कितना स्कोर मैं मिनिमम लूं कि ये सेक्शन में बड़े आराम से क्लियर कर लूं। ठीक है, तो उसी के लिए मैं आपको ये जो कट ऑफ है ये आपको बताना चाहूंगा। तो ये आपकी टोटल 20 क्वेश्चन क्वांट से इस सेक्शन से पूछे जाते हैं, जो कि 20 मार्क्स के होते हैं, और ये सारी की सारी आपकी ईयर वाइज कट ऑफ है जिसको आप पढ़ पा रहे होंगे। ठीक है, यानी कि यहां से अगर मैं बात करूं तो 1.25, और यहां से 4.25, और अगर 2018 की बात करें तो ये सिर्फ 4 मार्क्स थी, और 2017 की बात करें तो ये सिर्फ 3 मार्क्स थी आउट ऑफ 20। ठीक है, तो ये मिनिमम स्कोर है जो आपके लिए जरूरी है अगर आप मेंस एग्जाम में या टायर 2 वाले एग्जाम में आगे बढ़ना चाहते हैं। ठीक है, चलिए इसके बाद हम चर्चा करेंगे क्वांट के PYQ कंपैरिजन की, यानी पिछले 4 सालों का पूरा एनालिसिस यहां से हमने उठाया है। मैं टॉपिक वाइज नहीं बताने वाला आपको, अब इसके पीछे क्या कारण है, इसकी क्या जरूरत पड़ी हमें कि ये क्यों बताना चाहिए हमें। बहुत सारे बच्चे ऐसे होते हैं जो सिर्फ 1 साल के पेपर को उठा करके, जैसे 2020 का एक पेपर उठाया और वहीं से अपने आप को एनालाइज कर लिया कि ये टॉपिक खास तौर पे पूछे जाते हैं, और उन्हीं टॉपिक को तैयार करके एग्जाम में चले गए। बट वहां जाकर के देखते हैं तो जो क्वेश्चन है वो दूसरे टॉपिक से भी मिल जाते हैं उन्हें। तो इस बात का विशेष ख्याल रखना है आपको, जरूरी नहीं है कि एक पर्टिकुलर ईयर में जिस टॉपिक से क्वेश्चन पूछे गए वही बार बार दूसरे सालों में भी रिपीट होते हैं। ठीक है, तो ये कंप्लीट पूरा एनालिसिस है आपके पास 2017, 2018, 2019 और 2020 का, जिसको आपको देख लेना है कि किस टॉपिक से किस साल में क्वेश्चन पूछे गए। ठीक है, और इन्हीं टॉपिक को एनालाइज करने के बाद हमने एक स्ट्रेटेजी आप लोगों के लिए बनाई है कि किस तरीके से आपको क्वांट को आगे बढ़ाना है। ठीक है, तो उस स्ट्रेटेजी का पहला पार्ट क्या है, देखो बच्चे, सबसे पहला पार्ट होगा रीड प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस। जब भी आप अपनी तैयारी को आगे बढ़ाते हो, अपनी तैयारी को आप शुरू करते हो, तो आपको सबसे पहले प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस को जरूर पढ़ना है। और उसको पढ़ने के पीछे जो हमारा मकसद होता है वो क्या होता है, एक तो हमें ये पता चल जाता है कि कौन से टॉपिक रिलेवेंट है हमारे लिए और कौन सी चीजें इरेलेवेंट है, ताकि इरेलेवेंट चीजों पे आप अपनी एनर्जी वेस्ट ना करें। ठीक है, दूसरा आपको क्या करना है, स्टडी इन द गिवन सीक्वेंस। कुछ टॉपिक्स मैं आपको बता रहा हूं, ठीक है, ये आपके प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस को एनालाइज करके ही हमने पूरा सिलेबस आपका बनाया, बट आपको जब आप तैयारी कर रहे होते हैं तो आपको इसी सीक्वेंस में पढ़ना है। ठीक है, यानी कि सीक्वेंस आपकी यही रहेगी। इससे क्या फायदा होगा आपको इस सीक्वेंस में पढ़ने से, सबसे पहली चीज तो आपको ये मदद मिलेगी कि रेलेवेंट चीजें क्या है, दूसरा आपको टॉपिक्स को एक दूसरे से इंटरलिंकेज करना आसान होगा। बहुत सारे बच्चों को यह डर रहता है कि, या उनकी ये प्रॉब्लम रहती है कि मैंने एक टॉपिक पढ़ा, जैसे ही मैं दूसरा टॉपिक पढ़ना शुरू करता हूं पीछे वाला सारा साफ हो जाता है, मतलब मैं भूल गया उन कंसेप्ट को, भूल गया। इस सीक्वेंस में पढ़ने से जो पीछे वाली चीजें हैं वो भी साथ साथ चलती रहेंगी आपके। जैसे आप सिंपलीफिकेशन पढ़ेंगे तो यही सेम कंसेप्ट नंबर सीरीज में यूज होंगे, और जो यहां आप सीखेंगे वही क्वाड्रेटिक इक्वेशन में यूज होने वाला है, वही परसेंटेज रेशियो, अगर आप परसेंटेज और रेशियो पढ़ोगे तो वही DI में यूज होगा। यानी कि सीक्वेंस में पढ़ने से पिछले वाली चीजें भी आपके साथ के साथ रिवाइज होती चलेगी, सबसे बड़ा फायदा यह होगा। दूसरा, आपको हमेशा स्टडी फ्रॉम द बेसिक्स। आपको कभी भी ये जज नहीं करना कि बहुत हाई लेवल के क्वेश्चन पूछे जा रहे हैं उनको कैसे तैयार करेंगे, चाहे कितनी भी एडवांस चीजें आपसे पूछी जा रही है एग्जाम में, वो हमेशा बेसिक से ही बनती हैं। तो जब भी आप तैयारी करें तो हमेशा बेसिक से स्टार्ट करें। ठीक है, चौथा पॉइंट क्या है, प्रैक्टिस एटलीस्ट 50 क्वेश्चंस फ्रॉम एवरी टॉपिक। आपको क्या करना है, हर एक टॉपिक पढ़ने के बाद कम से कम 50 क्वेश्चन हर टॉपिक के प्रैक्टिस जरूर करने हैं। ठीक है, और एट द एंड प्रैक्टिस डाटा इंटरप्रिटेशन, सिंप्लीफिकेशन, नंबर सीरीज, क्वाड्रेटिक क्वेश्चन ऑन द रेगुलर बेसिस। ये टॉपिक ऐसे टॉपिक्स हैं, अगर मैं पिछले 4-5 सालों के पेपर्स को एनालाइज करता हूं तो इन्हीं टॉपिक्स से ज्यादा क्वेश्चन आपसे पूछे गए हैं, तो इन टॉपिक्स को आपको रेगुलर बेसिस पे तैयार करना है। आपको
सिर्फ कट ऑफ क्लियर नहीं करनी इस सेक्शन से कि मिनिमम मार्क्स नहीं लेने, क्योंकि आपकी जो ओवरऑल कट ऑफ जाती है वो ही तय करती है कि आप इसकी मुख्य परीक्षा में, इसके मेंस एग्जाम में बैठ पाएंगे कि नहीं बैठ पाएंगे। तो इसलिए ज्यादा से ज्यादा स्कोर करना है, और इन टॉपिक से मैक्सिमम क्वेश्चन पूछे जाते हैं क्वांट में, तो इन टॉपिक को आपको रेगुलर बेस पे जरूर प्रैक्टिस करना है। क्लियर है बच्चे? तो ये आपका रहेगा क्वांट के अंदर। दूसरा, अब मैं आपको रीजनिंग के बारे में भी यहां बताना चाहूंगा। सबसे पहले हम लोग बात करेंगे ईयर वाइज सेक्शनल कट ऑफ की। सबसे पहले देखो टोटल क्वेश्चन कितने पूछे जाते हैं, 20 मार्क्स के ही होते हैं, और ये पूरी आपकी ईयर वाइज कट ऑफ है 2017, 2018, 2019, 2020। बहुत कम जाती है, बट एक हर्डल है आपके लिए जिसे आपको क्रॉस करना बहुत जरूरी है, इसके बिना आप आगे नहीं बढ़ पाएंगे। ठीक है, तो इसको जरूर देख लीजिएगा आप लोग। और ये उन बच्चों के लिए है जो खासकर ये मानते हैं कि क्वांट और रीजनिंग अगर मेरा सिर्फ क्वालिफाई भी हो जाए, बाकी सेक्शंस में मैं अच्छा स्कोर कर लूंगा और मैं परीक्षा को निकाल लूंगा, तो ये उन लोगों के लिए। ठीक है, अब यहां पे मैं आपको रीजनिंग का भी पीवाईक्यू कंपैरिजन जरूर बताना चाहूंगा। ये पीवाईक्यू कंपैरिजन बताने के पीछे एक ही कारण है, आप उस कारण को ध्यान से समझिएगा। आप 2020 का पेपर देख के ये अंदाजा मत लगाइए कि एग्जाम में सिर्फ इन्हीं चार टॉपिक से क्वेश्चन पूछे जाएंगे। बीते सालों में अगर आप देखेंगे 2019 में इनसे पूछे गए, 2018 में इनसे पूछे गए, 2017 में यहां से पूछे गए। तो ये एनालिसिस आपको ये बताता है कि आपको अगर नोटिफिकेशन में सिलेबस नहीं भी मेंशन किया गया, तो प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस के आधार पे आप देखिए कि किन किन टॉपिक से कितने कितने क्वेश्चन पूछे जा रहे हैं, यानी हमें कौन कौन से टॉपिक पढ़ने हैं। तो उम्मीद करूंगा कि आप सबको ये समझ में आ गया होगा, और इसके बाद आपका एक सिलेबस जो है वो निर्धारित हो गया होगा कि हमें पढ़ना क्या है। ठीक है, अब बात करते हैं कि पढ़ना कैसे है। तो फिर से हमारी वही स्ट्रेटेजी रहेगी, सबसे पहले कि आपको प्रीवियस ईयर क्वेश्चंस को एनालाइज जरूर करना है। इससे एक तो आपको ये पता चल जाता है कि मोटा मोटा कैसी कैसी चीजें पूछी जा रही है, एग्जाम का पैटर्न कैसा है, ठीक है, और किस टाइप की लैंग्वेज वो यूज करता है। जब हम किसी बुक से पढ़ते हैं तो एक अलग टाइप की चीजें हमें मिलती है, जब वहां देखते हैं तो एक अलग टाइप की चीजें। तो ऐसा नहीं है, आप एनालाइज करके आप अपने आप को थोड़ा सा देख पाएंगे कि कैसी कैसी चीजें हमसे पूछी जा रही है। दूसरा, स्टडी इन द गिवन सीक्वेंस। इसके पीछे कारण वही है, अगर आप एक सीक्वेंस में पढ़ते हो तो चीजें जुड़ती जाती हैं, और कभी भी पीछे वाली चीजें पीछे नहीं छूटेंगी, वो साथ के साथ रन कर रही होती हैं आपके। ठीक है, तो इस सीक्वेंस में पढ़िए। सबसे पहले अल्फा न्यूमेरिक सीरीज, यही सेम लॉजिक कोडिंग एंड डिकोडिंग में यूज होते हैं, और यही सेम लॉजिक आपके मशीन इनपुट आउटपुट में यूज होते हैं, ये ध्यान रखिएगा। ठीक है, फिर इनइक्वालिटी, रैंकिंग, डायरेक्शन, ब्लड रिलेशन, सिलोगिज्म, सीटिंग अरेंजमेंट, पजल और एनालिटिकल रीजनिंग, ये सारे टॉपिक आपको इसी सीक्वेंस में पढ़ने हैं। ठीक है, तीसरा पॉइंट, स्टडी फ्रॉम द बेसिक्स। ये बात ध्यान रखिए, 200 टाइप के क्वेश्चन आपको मिल जाएंगे, आप जहां जहां से पढ़ेंगे अलग अलग चीजें आपको देखने को मिलेंगी, लेकिन हमेशा आपको स्टार्ट करना है बेसिक से। बेसिक से आप किसी भी क्वेश्चन को सोल्व कर पाओगे, चाहे वो कितनी भी हार्ड टाइप की सिचुएशन आपको क्यों ना दे दे। फिर आपको प्रैक्टिस करनी है, मिनिमम 50 क्वेश्चन उठाइए हर एक टॉपिक से, ये नेसेसरी है आपके लिए। ठीक है, इससे आप में कॉन्फिडेंस आएगा कि जो चीजें आपने पढ़ी है वो सही रास्ते पे है। ठीक है, और आप उन चीजों से सीख पा रहे हैं। ठीक है, और एक मैं चीज आपको यहाँ पे जोड़ देता हूँ, प्रैक्टिस सिटिंग अरेंजमेंट एंड पजल ऑन रेगुलर बेसिस। बहुत सारे बच्चों को दिक्कत होती है कि मैं बहुत कम टाइम में नहीं बना पा रहा हूं, क्योंकि आपने चीजें पढ़ी नहीं, इनको आपको यहां पे रेगुलरिटी की जरूरत है। अगर आप डेली प्रैक्टिस करेंगे तो आपका एक हाथ बैठ जाएगा इन चीजों के ऊपर। बहुत बच्चों को लगता है कि बिना पॉसिबिलिटी में सिटिंग अरेंजमेंट सोल्व नहीं कर पाता, पजल नहीं सोल्व कर पाता हूं, उसके पीछे कारण क्या है, क्योंकि आपने इनको दैनिक दिनचर्या में डाला ही नहीं। अगर आप डेली प्रैक्टिस कर रहे होते तो चीजें आपके दिमाग में ज्यादा रहेंगी, आपकी सोचने की क्षमता पे प्रभाव डालेंगी, और फिर आपको पजल्स में या सिटिंग अरेंजमेंट में किसकी लोकेशन कहाँ लेनी है, किसको कहाँ बैठाना है, ये चीजें आपके लिए आसान रहेंगी। क्लियर है बच्चे? तो इस सिक्वेंस में पढ़िएगा, बेसिक से पढ़िएगा, प्रैक्टिस करिएगा खूब सारी, और इन दो टॉपिक्स पे, और साथ में मैं दो टॉपिक और ऐड कर देता हूँ, इनइक्वालिटी और सिलोगिज्म, इन दोनों टॉपिक्स की भी आपको जरूर प्रैक्टिस करनी है रेगुलर बेसिस पे। ठीक है, तो चार टॉपिक आपके लिए यहां से रहेंगे। क्लियर है? अब एट द एंड एक क्वेरी है जो बहुत मायने रखती है, आप लोगों को बार बार हमसे पूछते हैं कि सर जैसे आरबीआई में इस बार थोड़ा सा पैटर्न चेंज होके आ गया क्वेश्चंस का, अगर इस बार भी ऐसा रहता है तो हम क्या करेंगे। ठीक है, यानी इस ओल्ड पैटर्न में और न्यू पैटर्न में डिफरेंस क्या है, सबसे पहले चर्चा ये कर लेते हैं हम। ठीक है, कि जब भी कोई पैटर्न बदलता है हम पीवाईक्यू को देख करके तैयारी करते हैं, और जब कोई न्यू पैटर्न एग्जाम में आता है तो उसके पीछे तीन कारण, एग्जाम का पैटर्न का बदलाव हम किस तरीके से देखते हैं। पहली बात तो ध्यान रखिए, जब भी पैटर्न चेंज होता है तो सिलेबस चेंज नहीं होता कभी भी, समझ रहे हैं? अगर सिलेबस चेंज करना होगा तो वो आपको नोटिफिकेशन में स्पेशल डाल के देता है कि भाई अब इस बार हम इन इन टॉपिक से क्वेश्चन पूछेंगे। ठीक है, चेंज क्या होता है, चेंज होता है नंबर ऑफ क्वेश्चन, ठीक है, यानी कि हो सकता है कि एक पर्टिकुलर टॉपिक से पिछले सालों में कम क्वेश्चन पूछे गए हों, इस बार ज्यादा पूछ लिए, या पिछले सालों में जिन टॉपिक से क्वेश्चन पूछे गए इस बार पूछे ही नहीं, बट वो सिलेबस में तो थे आपके, ठीक है। दूसरा होता है नेचर ऑफ क्वेश्चन, यानी कि आपका डिफिकल्टी लेवल चेंज हो सकता है, ठीक है। पिछली बार इजी पूछे गए थे, इस बार हो सकता है डिफिकल्ट पूछे गए, बट आप ये बात यहाँ पे समझने की कोशिश करिएगा, अगर लेवल चेंज होगा, नेचर ऑफ क्वेश्चन चेंज होगा, तो अगर उसका इफेक्ट कट ऑफ पे भी पड़ता है, वो आपकी पेशेंस की भी परीक्षा होती है कि आप कितने कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ आए हैं और आप में कितनी पेशेंस है। आप आरबीआई का ही एग्जांपल लेंगे तो लास्ट ईयर कट ऑफ 122 और इस बार कट ऑफ 60 समथिंग, समझ रहे हैं, 62 पॉइंट समथिंग, तो उसका एक इफेक्ट पड़ता है। तो कभी भी नेचर ऑफ क्वेश्चन चेंज होगा तो कट ऑफ भी चेंज होगी, तो आपको उसको ज्यादा एक बर्डन के तरीके से नहीं लेना, एग्जाम में पेशेंस के साथ सोल्व करना होता है। तीसरी चीज क्या, टाइप ऑफ क्वेश्चन, ठीक है, यानी कि क्वेश्चन पूछने का तरीका चेंज हो सकता है। जैसे मैं एक छोटा सा एग्जाम्पल लूं, पहले क्वाड्रेटिक इक्वेशन के क्वेश्चन इस तरीके से पूछे जाते थे, एक छोटा सा एग्जाम्पल है कि और वाई स्क्वायर माइनस 10y प्लस 30 लाइक दिस, दो इक्वेशन देगी, इन्हें कंपेयर करना था, और उन्हीं क्वेश्चन के टाइप्स को चेंज करके इस बार क्वेश्चन कैसा आ गया कि उसने दो कॉलम बना दिए कि एक कॉलम वन यहाँ है, एक कॉलम टू यहाँ पे है, ये कॉलम वन है आपका और ये कॉलम टू होगा इधर की तरफ, और उसने तीन इक्वेशन दे दी, इक्वेशन वन एक्स की फॉर्म में है, ये वाई की फॉर्म में है और ये जेड की फॉर्म में है, और यहाँ पे रूट दिए हुए हैं, और आपको बताना है कि करेक्टली मैच पेयर कौन सा नहीं है। इससे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ा, आप इस बात को समझिए, चीजें यही है, बस उसने क्या किया, थोड़ा सा उसका स्वभाव चेंज कर दिया, यानी कि पूछने का तरीका उसका चेंज हो गया, है तो वही चीज है ना सेम। तो इन चीजों से कभी घबराना नहीं है, अब बेसिक से पढ़ के गए हैं, अच्छे से पढ़ के गए हैं, तो एग्जाम में आप अपनी आउटपुट उतनी ही दे पाएंगे तब भी, अगर आपकी तैयारी वैसी होगी तो, ठीक है। तो ये ओल्ड पैटर्न न्यू पैटर्न का आपके दिमाग में संशय नहीं रहना चाहिए अभी, कि अगर चेंज होके आता है तो हम क्या करेंगे, आप हमेशा बेसिक से पढ़ के जाइए, अच्छे से पढ़ के जाइए, और जब भी एग्जाम में अगर थोड़ा बहुत पैटर्न चेंज होके आता है तो एक तो आपकी पेशेंस की परीक्षा है, दूसरा आपकी नॉलेज की भी परीक्षा है कि आपने अगर बेसिक से पढ़ा है तो चीजें तो मैं वैसे ही पूछ रहा हूँ ना, उसमें कोई फर्क नहीं है, समझ रहे हैं, बस पूछने का तरीका बदल दिया, एक डिफरेंट टाइप का क्वेश्चन आ गया, तो इन चीजों पे आपको जरूर काम करना है, ठीक है। तो उम्मीद है कि आप सबको ये समझ में आ गया होगा बहुत अच्छे तरीके से, तो मैं वापिस से फिर रितिका मैम को ओवर टू करूंगा कि वो आगे अपने इस वेबिनार को बढ़ाए, तो थैंक यू वेरी मच गाइज।
थैंक यू बीटी सर, यू हैव ट्रूली ट्राई टू सिंप्लीफाई द क्वांट एंड रीजनिंग पार्ट। सो सर, व्हाट आई कुड अंडरस्टैंड फ्रॉम योर स्ट्रेटजी, थ्री कीवर्ड्स यू हैव गिवन, आई हैव नोटेड दीस थ्री कीवर्ड्स, दे आर सीक्वेंस, बेसिक्स एंड प्रैक्टिस। सो बेसिकली इफ अ स्टूडेंट प्रिपेयर्स इन अ सीक्वेंस, then follows the basics, if the basics are cleared, and then practice a lot. You have to do the practice on a daily basis. Rather, do not keep your quant and reasoning practice for, let's say, last 10 days, right? This is what you have been trying to tell. You have also shared with us the most important topics which students should cover, like DI. I can see students were asking, sir, what would be the level of DI in the paper? Would you like to answer that also? Okay, what is the expected level of DI, or what has it been earlier?
मैम, अगर मैं पिछले 4-5 साल के क्वेश्चंस को एनालाइज करूंगा तो डाटा इंटरप्रिटेशन का जो लेवल है नाबार्ड का, देखो हर एक एग्जाम की अपनी प्रकृति होती है, थोड़ा सा अपना नेचर होता है कि वो आपसे क्या एक्सपेक्ट कर रहा है, ठीक है। तो आपको यहाँ पे देखना है कि नाबार्ड के पेपर में वो आपसे ESI या थोड़ा एग्रीकल्चर के पार्ट पे ज्यादा फोकस करता है, तो क्वांट और रीजनिंग हमेशा नॉर्मली पूछे गए, इतने कोई अच्छे लेवल से क्वांट रीजनिंग नहीं पूछे गए, बहुत आसान थे कि मतलब आप 40 में से 40 स्कोर भी कर सकते हैं इजीली, ठीक है। बट ये हमारे हाथ में नहीं है कि आगे आने वाले एग्जाम का पैटर्न किस तरीके से होगा, बट अगर आप बेसिक से प्रिपेयर करके जाते हैं, आपका कंसेप्ट क्लियर है, आपको पता है कि परसेंटेज को कैसे यूज करना है, अगर आप पाई चार्ट बना रहे हैं तो 360 डिग्री को 100% में कैसे कन्वर्ट करना है, या अर्थमेटिक बेस्ड डीआई आ जाती है, बहुत सारे एग्जाम्स में अर्थमेटिक बेस्ड डीआई पूछ रहा है आजकल, तो उसमें भी आपका अगर बेसिक कंसेप्ट क्लियर होगा, जैसे टाइम एंड वर्क है, टाइम एंड डिस्टेंस पे बेस्ड डाटा इंटरप्रिटेशन आ जाता है, और आपको पता है कि टाइम स्पीड और डिस्टेंस को किस तरीके से सोल्व करना है, रिलेटिव स्पीड का कंसेप्ट क्या है, तो उन चीजों को बनाना भी मुश्किल नहीं है, ठीक है। तो लेवल हार्ड या इजी नहीं होता कभी भी, अगर मुझे कुछ नहीं आता तो वो मेरे लिए हार्ड है, अगर मुझे सब कुछ आता तो वो इजी है, चाहे वो मुश्किल भी क्यों ना हो, ठीक है। तो बेसिक से पढ़ के जाइए, उसका कोई इफेक्ट नहीं होगा बच्चे, और अगर थोड़ा अच्छे लेवल से पूछ भी लेता है तो कट ऑफ भी तो देख रहे हैं हम, जैसे लास्ट ईयर उस एग्जाम में देखी थी, तो अगर थोड़ा सा पैटर्न बढ़ के भी आ जाता है तो पेशेंस की परीक्षा है, वो वहां से आप इजीली निकल जाते हैं।
थैंक यू सर, Great. Thank you for the insightful information, sir. You have to do your basics right. That is the idea behind quant and reasoning that I could understand. If the paper is difficult, don't worry. Cutoff is going to drop down, right? If your preparation, basic preparation is good enough, you can clear quant reasoning part, right?
Yes.
So thank you, VD sir. Now we will move on to a very important part again of phase one, that is English. I would say quant, reasoning and English are three topics out of which students are very curious about how to do. They actually dread these three topics, right? So Narveer sir, please give us your insightful information about the phase one English.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So guys, first of all, I wish all my dear aspirants a safe environment, and please follow the social distancing and maintain all the, take all the precautions, guys. First of all, now coming to the exam, yes, guys, I could see there are a few skeptical students asking about the dates of the exams. So guys, yes, we have got this information that the exams would be the notifications would be out by the 15th of June, and phase one would be conducted somewhat in July, right? So looking at the timeline, what I would say that you must start preparing for all the subjects and initially with phase one. As ma'am also told you that this exam carries 200 questions, out of which the weightage, the most of the weightage are for these three sections, ARD, ESI, and English, right? 40 questions each, and the rest of the subjects are 20 questions each. So I would like to share my analysis from the previous year questions, previous year papers, and I would like to share something very peculiar to you. So guys, I would like to share something with you. So pay attention to the screen now. So guys, yes, I hope you can see my screen. So guys, this is the strategy for NABARD Grade A phase one for particularly English section, right? So first of all, guys, I would like to show you something which would actually boost your morale and which would actually give you a bit of confidence. So guys, as ma'am also told you, there are 40 questions, and the weightage of these 40 questions is also 40 marks. Now, looking at the cutoff for the past 4 years, now we can analyze something out of it, which is very, very important for you to understand. Now, beginning from the year 2017, the cutoff was 6.5 out of 40 marks. In 2018, it shot up to 13.75 marks. Then in 2019, it was 11.25 marks. And in the year 2020, it was 8.5 marks. So guys, this is out of 40. So guys, if you understand, this is not too high of a score to actually achieve during your exam, even if your basics are just there, clear. So as VDs are also emphasized on the same thing, you should be well versed with your basics. You should you should be clear with your strategy that this is the amount of time I have, and this is the sectional cutoff and overall cutoff that we must reach. Now, there is something that we always suggest to you guys, which we call SWOT analysis. So always try to analyze yourself before you walk into that exam. And I think everybody does it in their head, right? You already know before you walk into the exam, what are your strong subjects and what are your weak subjects. So looking at the weightage as well as your preparation, so you must focus on certain sections of each subject so that you can at least clear the sectional cutoff, as well as you can also clear the overall cutoff of this paper. And remember this, guys, the marks for phase one are not added into phase two or the final selection, right? So basically this exam is just to get to the next stage, and this is where we have to work very, very smartly. So I could see many doubts or many questions from the students, sir, is it possible to prepare for NABARD If we start from very scratch from day one, that would be today. I would say, yes, it is absolutely possible, guys. It's all about your strategy, your perseverance, and your commitment to your preparation. So this was the chart for cutoff for previous year exams for English. Now, guys, what are the basic questions that are usually seen in the exams? And I've collected all the general pattern or a trend, we can say, for the questions that are being thrown at the students or at the aspirants during the exam. So guys, in the past 4 years, I've always seen that there is always a reading comprehension, which could be for 10 marks, ranging up to 15 marks. So there could be 10 to 15 questions on reading comprehension, but the passage is quite moderate to comprehend, and the questions are also not very difficult. So this is one scoring part where you can score very well, right? Other is word replacement. So you will be given a sentence or double blanks to replace them with appropriate words. Now they're usually easy to moderate if you have a good command over your reading ability and your comprehension skills, including the vocabulary part. Now there are obviously close test and fill in the blanks for 5 marks. Then there is this section which is based on grammar. So sentence rearrangement, this is about comprehension. Error detection, that is based on grammar. And there are some miscellaneous questions. For example, idioms and phrases or phrasal verbs are also asked. So this is the breakdown of the paper for 40 questions, what you may expect this time as well. So guys, if looking at the cutoff, now it has never been more than 13, right? So even if you prepare only couple of sections from this, from these questions, you will be able to score very well. One, reading comprehension. Second, error detection. I would feel this is very economical because you read a question sentence and you can find out the erroneous part in it. Again, fill in the blanks, very economical. Read a sentence and then choose the right word to be, which fits the blank. So basically, even if you prepare for certain sections, you will be able to score very well in this paper, guys. But yes, I would suggest you should be, you should be well-versed with all the topics and all this, all the subtopics of this particular section. So I will come to this part now, which particular areas to focus upon, right? So key areas to focus upon. First is your grammatical accuracy. And this is not just for phase one, guys. I would remind you, you also have a descriptive English paper for phase two, and wherein you won't have questions to answer, multiple choice questions to answer. There you'll have to articulate your ideas into an essay or frame a pressy, or you have to draft your answers for reading comprehension along with drafting a letter or a report. So grammatical accuracy is very important. So please brush up on your grammatical rules and be well-versed. You should have a sound knowledge of, grammatical sense of this language, guys. That is the foremost part for this paper because it helps everywhere. Guys, grammar, what I have always felt is the, you can say, foundation of English language. So unless your foundation is weak, you can never expect a very, a fancy house standing for centuries, right? I hope you're getting what analogy I'm using. I know it was a bad analogy, but I hope you understand what I'm getting at, right? So grammatical accuracy is very important for this paper. Second is your comprehension ability. Now guys, many students have this dilemma, sir, how to improve our comprehension ability. Now always have a habit of reading. Guys, we have always been emphasizing on, to develop a habit of reading, and not just for English, this helps you in n number of ways, guys. Whatever you read, whatever you come across, I think the language is English, right? Even if you're reading ARD, ESI, you're using English. So try to focus on the language. So whenever you are going through an editorial, whenever you're reading newspaper or any article whatsoever, wherever from. So please make it a habit to understand the way of presentation. Certain words, certain keywords to remember so that your drafting also improves. So that is what we call comprehension ability. So comprehension is basically to read and understand what the author wants to convey and to read between the lines as well. So that is going to be very, very crucial in this paper. Now, third section is obviously vocabulary. There are questions based on synonyms, antonyms, one word substitution. Then there are idioms and phrases. There are phrasal verbs which are usually asked in the exam. So vocabulary also plays a very important role, and it will develop as you work through both these sections. Your grammar is sound. You are in a habit of reading every day. Your vocabulary will develop itself. But please make sure that you intently focus on remembering the words. So that's how you can improve your vocabulary. And the fourth part which I would like to stress upon is efficiency and accuracy, guys. Because unless, you may be very good at English, your comprehension may be at par, but if your answers are not correct, what I mean is if you have not practiced enough and if your time management is not there now, that would lead to a reduction of marks. So I would also stress upon your efficiency and accuracy. What do I mean by efficiency? Within a specific amount of time, how many questions can you attempt? And the other part is accuracy. Out of those attempted questions, how many questions can you get correct? So these are four key areas to focus on in English, guys. Now, again, strategy, how to prepare for this particular exam. Now, guys, there are four simple steps to follow. Start with your previous year questions, guys. We have also provided you all the previous year exams in our courses, and you can also find it very easily. So start with the previous year paper. Take it like a test in a time-bound manner, as a simulation of a test, right? Let's see how much you score, and that would be your SWOT analysis. Now you would know which areas to focus on and which areas you can work with. So start previous year questions, read previous year questions so that you are able to comprehend what type of questions are given to you, what level of passages are thrown at you, and you would face the real situation, the real scenario. Then study in the given sequence. Now, what sequence am I talking about? This is the sequence that you should follow. And these are some important topics that I've shortlisted for my dear aspirants so that they can start working with this. Start with subject verb agreement, including tenses, conditional sentences, preposition. These are very important. They are always thrown at you in the exams. Then conjunctions, advanced verbs, synonym, antonyms. Obviously, you will start after you've covered your grammatical portion. Phrasal verbs, this comes under vocabulary. Then comes your comprehension part, which includes reading comprehension, close test, parajumbles, or we also call them rearrangement of sentences. And then idioms and phrases. Put idioms and phrases at the last, because they are usually seen in the exams, but if you study in this sequence, it would really help you to build up your confidence, your morale, and your basics of the language as well. Now, study from basics that I have already stressed upon. If you feel that your grammar needs brushing up, start with that. If you feel that, okay, my grammar is good, I'm good to go with grammar, then start with vocabulary. If you think that my grammar and vocabulary are up to the mark, then go with comprehension. And start with previous year questions so that you can get a real idea. And obviously practice at least 50 questions from each of these sections. So that would be my strategy for the next 1 month or so that you have for your preparation. Right, guys? So that is it for phase one from my side. And anything you wish to ask, guys, please feel free to do so. And ma'am, back to Ritika, ma'am. I hope we have covered everything for English section. Please do let me know if you need to talk about anything else, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. That was a simple and lovely strategy. You have actually given the topics that need to be prepared. Sir, I have a question. Many students were asking this. Although most of the students I can see, they are more worried about descriptive English. So yes, right. We are going to discuss, Navi sir is going to discuss about descriptive English. After we discuss about phase one and ESI-ARD, then we will, sir will come back to your descriptive part, right? But sir, one question I could see, students are asking that will the level of phase one paper of NABARD, will it be equal to IBPS examinations? Like, because many students are appearing in the banking examination, so probably that is why this query.
Right, ma'am. I absolutely understand the dilemma. And, guys, there are two things that we must understand here. One is level of questions. You can say the level of questions would be somewhat equivalent to IBPS, but the difference is the type of questions, ma'am. So that is what I would like to convey to my dear aspirants, that it's about the type of questions. Usually IBPS, almost half of the paper is similar to that of IBPS. I mean, reading comprehension is there, sentence rearrangement is there, close test is there. But the rest 20 marks, the rest 20 questions are a bit different. Because the questions I've seen in NABARD, they have never been inculcated or they have never been used in any IBPS exam in the previous year whatsoever. Right, ma'am? So error detection is, it looks common, it looks similar, but the presentation of questions is sometime different. You know, okay, I would like to elaborate on that. What happens, IBPS, what they usually do is they put out a sentence, they break the sentence into 5 parts, and then they usually ask you to find the erroneous part. But what NABARD usually does is, it also gives you a sentence, but it does not ask you to find the erroneous part. There was a paper when they gave 4 parts out of 5 parts which had errors in it, and there was only 1 part which had no error in it. And we had to find the error, the part which had no error in it. So many students, they do not read the instructions or the directions of the questions very carefully. They rush, they try to rush through the exam. So I would advise not to do so. And then there were questions where you can see double fillers are there. Then there are pairing of words. You know, there would be 2 sentences with 1 blank each, and there would be 5 words of, 5 options from which you have to choose 1 blank which fits both the sentences. So, ma'am, the type of questions are a tad bit different than IBPS. But yes, level of questions, you could say it is somewhat equivalent or somewhat on the higher side from IBPS PO, ma'am. Not clerk, IBPS PO. It would be higher than IBPS PO, ma'am.
So I think that answers the questions, that yes, that preparation is anyhow going to help. But obviously, you cannot expect the same level of questions, right? But of course, your preparation is not going to be like waste. It is going to rather uplift you in this examination also, right? Thank you, Nabi sir. So we will come back to you for descriptive English strategy. And yes, one more question, please, sir, to you. So would you like to suggest any specific newspaper for like students are asking? Because many students are there who are just pursuing their degrees. So any specific newspaper would you suggest?
I would do that in the later part of this video, ma'am. But yes, if they're asking, guys, many students or many teachers I've seen, they start with the Hindu. Okay. It is a good paper. Nonetheless, it's a brilliant publication. But at the same point of time, if I look at a specific, mindset of this exam, now everybody knows there's a lot of emphasis on ARD and ESI in this particular exam. So I would suggest you would not just go around reading everything from the newspaper, but you have to act smartly and choose only those articles or those particular news that are related to either current affairs or ARD and ESI somewhat, ma'am. That would, I would say, is a smart approach. Now, even if you find it in the Hindu or the Indian Express or the Economic Times, these are some, these newspapers that we come across every day. And there are some good online websites as well, ma'am. For example, LiveMint. I've seen LiveMint has very good articles. And then there is PIB. So we can consult any of these, any of these sources to stay updated, as well as to prepare for this particular exam. So guys, yes, the Hindu, but there are some students who are, I've seen this, that they feel sir, Hindu is for UPSC. So NABARD is nowhere behind UPSC in any case. So yes, start with the Hindu. Then if you find it, if you find it easy, or if you find it comprehensible, otherwise you can start with Indian Express or the Economic Times. Or if you are in a habit of reading online, then you can go with LiveMint or PIB, ma'am. So that would be my suggestion to you. But yes, I would also be giving you a list of newspapers and sources to where to prepare from.
Right. So thank you for that. And yes, sir, very important thing you have mentioned, I would like to underline that any newspaper, any sources useful, if you know what to extract from it, right? So many newspapers are there, you are reading those newspapers, but if you do not know what is relevant for your examination, there is no use of it assess it. Because I would suggest you that when you're preparing for this examination, you have to converge many things. Like if you're preparing for English, you're reading a newspaper. Use that newspaper, which would be helpful for your current affairs also. That will boost up your preparation for ESI knowledge, ARD knowledge, and of course, English also, right? So thank you, Naveed sir, once again. Moving on to computer awareness. So our faculty member, Veena ma'am, is here. She will be shedding light on computer awareness, how to deal with this particular subject of phase one, exclusive phase one.
Thank you, Ritika ma'am. So hello, friends. Hope you all are doing well. So, you know, computer knowledge, this is one of the very, very important subject, you know, for phase one. Why there are, you know, this subject or this particular computer knowledge, it is highly scoring subject. You know, sometimes you even can score 20 out of 20 in this. So now we shall see, you know, there are few questions that students always, you know, face, you know, related to the subject computer knowledge. What is the syllabus? See, as such, there is no prescribed syllabus for computer knowledge, but yes, based on the previous year questions analysis since the past few years, you know, we have already arrived at a particular syllabus. Okay, these are the various topics from which questions will be asked in computers. So these are the various topics. You might have already gone through this list, you know, so, you know, many a times in, you know, on various platforms or on various channels. So I'll not dig deeper into this, but yes, you need to understand three important aspects, you know, related to computer knowledge. One, it is highly scored, that you can score even 20 out of 20. Two, please focus on the basics. Whatever the topics, be it computer awareness or MS Office, you know, as per the items or the topics that have been enlisted here, please focus on the basics. This is what we have seen since the past few years. The questions that were asked from these topics are from basics only. So you need not go through any particular book, no need to buy any book. This is available everywhere, you know, even on YouTube also. If you go through, we at EduTap also last year, we have launched, you know, 1,000 MCQs, series. So that also is very helpful, and only basics you need to do. Three, do as many questions or as possible from each of these topics. That is what, you know, that's a major, you know, these three points you need to focus for computer knowledge. Coming to cutoffs, you need to understand that. See, since 2017 till 2020, these are the cutoffs. It is very easy to, you know, cross this cutoff. But yes, if you score high here, that would be really helpful for you, you know, to add that marks to your final cutoff. So highly scoring, easily scoring, basics you need to focus, and this would help you in, you know, achieving the final cutoff. There is, you know, not much to add here, but these are the things that you need to focus. And yes, please do as many mock tests or as many questions as possible. And, you know, in computer knowledge, what I have observed is we know everything. Since we do, you know, on a daily basis, since the past few years, it has been, you know, it has become common that people using laptops, computers, etc., doing, you know, on Word, Excel, various, you know, hardwares, etc., we are working on them. But yes, the thing is, we are not acclimatized to the concepts, especially the concepts related to it. We know everything, but if I ask you what is a ribbon in my MS Office, you won't be, I mean, suddenly if I ask, that would, you won't be able to answer. But yes, these are the concepts that you need to understand. For example, there was a question in the previous year examination. What is the shortcut for selecting all in MS Word? If you ask me, even without seeing, I'll say it's Control plus A. While typing, I can do that. If you ask me, it would be difficult. That's the reason I'm asking you, do as many questions as possible. And there was a question on printer hardwares also. It was at a printer that can't print graphics. We all know that, you know, Daisy will printer, but when it comes to answering the question, it becomes a little bit difficult. So my only suggestion here is focus on the basics, do as many questions as possible, and see that, you know, to score, see that you can score as many marks as possible here with the whatever points I have mentioned till now. So friends, this is all from my end here. If you have any questions, you can ask, and I'll hand over it to Ritika ma'am so that she can take it, she can take the webinar forward.
Thank you, Veena ma'am. So you have basically shared a list of topics. Questions are basic in nature, you have told us. They're not difficult questions are asked, but you are sometimes not even able to answer basic questions if you have not brushed up your basics. If you feel that, okay, I know everything. I work on computer, I study on computer, I will be able to answer all the questions. No, please just brush up your basics, right? And also, when you brush up your basics, that does not mean you have to go and find a book and just cover to cover you read that computer book, okay? Just topics are there, important topics you've shared, refer to those practice questions that will be enough. That is what I could take away from this computer. And of course, it is scoring also, ma'am, right? The section is really scoring.
Highly scoring, ma'am. If you know, one can focus on these basics, do lot good amount of practice. Highly scoring. Even I have seen students scoring, you know, 20 out of 20 in this, and that will really give an edge to the student when it comes to final cutoff and clearing the phase one. Because sometimes students would be a little bit weak in other subjects also. They can compensate that here by scoring high here, and it's easy also. It's not that difficult.
So this subject offers a chance to balance out your difficult part. Yes. The quant reasoning you can balance out through the computers, right?
Right, ma'am. Okay.
So thank you, Veena ma'am. Now I can see many questions are here. Students are asking that what questions are related to ESI ARD. Also, so guys, as I said in the beginning, that we are first taking up the phase one exclusive topics and subjects, because first of all we need to clear prelims, your phase one, right? Then we will of course take up your ESI ARD. An elaborate strategy would be shared by Avinash sir, Veena ma'am, right, on that. And of course myself would also be there. So one question I would like to address here, that you are asking, are the material, the material which is provided in the course, is it enough? So guys, yes, the material is more than enough, okay? You have to understand what is the requirement of the examination. We have prepared your material on the same lines. Practice enough, cover your syllabus, know the requirement of the examination, and that's it. This is what I would like to share with you, right? So coming to general awareness, so I would say, I'll just show you the general awareness importance, just like computer, as ma'am did. Right. So guys, see. First of all, I would like to show the cutoff of general awareness. This is of unreserved category. Right. So in 2020, out of 20 marks, general awareness is of 20 marks in phase one, and it is exclusive in phase one. J is not there in phase two, right? Unlike ESI and AR. So 2020, 1.75, 2019, 2.5, 2018, 3. So it is easy to clear the sectional cutoff because it is not high. But let me tell you, just like computer examination, computer knowledge, GA gives you an opportunity to take your score to a fly high mode, right? This is a component which you can prepare in a short span of time, given you know what needs to be prepared, what is the requirement of the examination. You not only clear the cutoff, that you will be able to do. You can see cutoff is not really high, but through this, you can take your score up. I'll just share with you, like, what is general awareness? If you are new here to the examination, I can see many students are here. So guys, general awareness has two components, current affairs and static GA. So current affairs, if we see the pattern of the examination, are more important as compared to static. Why? The weightage is more. Out of 20, I would say 10 to 15 on an average. It is 15. It can go less than that also in upcoming examination. But 15 marks decently can be given to current affairs, right? 5 marks to static GK we can give. Now, what is static GK, guys? Static GK is the capital of, let's say, any country, capital of any state, or the location of any dam, right? These are all static part, which are not going to change very soon. While current affairs are, you have to prepare on a daily basis, right? So now, what all do you need to prepare for general awareness? I'll share the topics with you, right? If you know what you need to prepare, you will easily find those sources. How? That also. So guys, your general awareness has very important two topics, economics and social issues related current affairs, and agriculture and rural development related current affairs. This means that ESI and ARD current affairs preparation that you are doing for phase 1 and phase 2 both is going to be helpful for GA also. Only if you understand this, okay? Let me give you an example. If government has released any scheme, which is for the insurance of the farmers, the yield insurance, is that not a part of general awareness? Do you need to know about agriculture scheme only if you are preparing for agriculture examination? No, right? Agriculture is a very important part of our economy. So you have to know that as generally also. That is what you have to understand. Whatever you read, keep in mind that that can be asked in GA also, right? Then guys, your agreements, MOUs, treaties at national as well as international level. Let me tell you a very important thing. 3 months prior to your examination are very, very important. When I say very important, I can even mean out of 15 current affairs questions, 14 are from these 3 months, okay? Please mark that. Then guys, government schemes are, of course, you are going to prepare those government schemes for your ESI, ARD, again, helpful in GA, reports, rankings, GDP forecast, banking plus finance current affairs related to NABARD specifically. So these topics, na guys, like ESI, ARD, schemes, reports, banking, finance, these are your common topics for phase 1 and phase 2 for ESI, ARD, GA. If you understand this, I would say your preparation would become easy, okay? Coming to some topics that are not going to be asked in ESI, ARD, because obviously they are not a part of the syllabus, like summits, conventions, books, authors, persons in news, sports, any sports event has recently taken place, defense-related topics, days in news, so many days are observed, be it national, international, then the themes, science, technology-related questions. So these are the topics of current affairs. Now, if you are referring to newspapers, and if you know that you need to pick up these topics, right, you can cover those. If you are not aware about these topics, how will you cover? Even while reading current your newspaper, you will skip that, okay? Now, if you are following our course, then of course, you must know that we are providing a comprehensive magazine containing all these things, right? We refer to all important sources and cover all the current affairs for GA. Now, one thing I would like to highlight here related to static. Guys, your static is related to GA. Please mark my words. While preparing for current affairs, if you keep an eye on the related static part also, then it will be easy for you to clear static questions also. Let me give you an example. This Joe Biden has recently been appointed as the president, elected as the president of USA, right? What is the capital of USA? Now, this is a current news. Joe Biden has been in news a lot. USA has been in news, but do you know the capital of USA? Do you know the currency? Currency, I'm sure you must be knowing. Okay, dollar, very famous, but capital, you have to know. So if you streamline, you think this in your mind, that if, let's say, some state, some national park is in news, what is the location of that national park? Where is it located? If you cover those things, you are covering your static part automatically, right? I hope this helps you to cover your general awareness part, right? So, thank you for your time, guys. Now, I think we are done with your phase 1 exclusive topics, right? So, let's move on to the very important part of your examination. I would say the two subjects which are the deal breaker of this exam. Economics and social issues and agriculture and rural development. Now, I want to share one thing with you, my dear friends. ESI and ARD have two pillars, static and current, just like your GA, okay? The GA division, we can still take on less priority because the weightage, the number of questions are less. But ESI, ARD, 40 marks each in phase 1 and then 100 marks paper in phase 2, right? So I will hand over the screen to Avinash sir. Avinash sir will be taking up your ESI static strategy, right? Sir, please. Shed light on the strategy to deal with ESI static.
Hello, students. So, ma'am used a word that caught my attention, deal breaker, right? That ESI can be deal breaker and ESI static in particularly can be a deal breaker if you don't know how to handle it. I was reading all the queries and comments that you have been kind enough in sharing. And Mr. Rakesh Vishwakarma has asked a question. That is it important to cover the entire static syllabus of ESI, given that it is so vast, it is so huge, right? So I'm going to answer all these questions now, right? I'm going to share my screen with you. I have prepared a small, you know, I've gotten some pointers for you. And I would just show those pointers to you and I will answer your questions one by one in the course of showing these points to you. Now, this is the huge syllabus that Mr. Vishwakarma was talking about, right? It's a huge syllabus, right? It covers everything. Don't try to read it, right? It's a huge syllabus and you should know the syllabus, right? You should be knowing the syllabus by heart, okay? Why? You should be knowing your syllabus by heart, right? Because so that when you are coming across articles in newspaper, you know which part of the syllabus that is related to. So you'll be able to understand. Like for example, you come across a fantastic article regarding what is the level of poverty. So poverty is there in the syllabus. You come across a fantastic article regarding, let us say, literacy rate in India. So you know that it is mentioned in the syllabus. You come across a very good article talking about human development index. So you know that it is mentioned in the syllabus. You come across a very good article regarding food security in India. So you know that you need to read that article. Why? Because it is mentioned in the syllabus. So we are not here to read this syllabus. I'm going to break it down into simple to understand parts. But the most important thing is that you should remember the syllabus so that you can select the articles that you want to read, so that you can select the issues that you want to educate yourself about, because probably question can be asked from that. So you should know the syllabus. Moving ahead, right? There are certain common queries that I always come across so far as ESI is concerned. I'm going to put those queries out for you, right? And I'll address those queries one by one. ESI static syllabus is vast. How to cover it? Answer is very simple, very logical, very rational. Please prioritize the syllabus, right? Not everything within the syllabus needs to be read very thoroughly, very deeply. So what you should do is that you should first finish most important chapters. Which are the most important chapters? ESI static economics chapters are more important than social issues chapter. That is point number one, right? So what you should do is that if you're starting now, somebody was saying that if I want to start now and I want to clear the exam, what should I do, right? So be very focused, be very specific in picking up ESI static economics chapters and do them first, right? Giving due weightage to other components of the exam. Like for example, VD sir's QRE should be given importance, right? Narveer sir's English should be given importance. Veena ma'am's computer should be given importance because you have to clear phase one. Some amount of importance has to be given to ESI static also. So thoda sa ESI static economics you must read, right? How important is ESI static in terms of marks in the exam is the next important question, right? Now, here is where there is a very important point that needs to be noted, that if you see the trend, right, if you see the trend over here that is visible, right, you can see that the number of questions that have been asked from ESI static have been far and few between, right? Some may say that when such less number of questions are being asked, you know, single digit questions are being asked, then what is the point of doing ESI static, right? Should we leave ESI static? Should we focus exclusively on ESI current? So the answer is somewhere in between. You should prioritize ESI current affairs, right? You should study government schemes and programs, as ma'am will tell you. You should study reports and indices, as ma'am will tell you. You should prioritize ESI current affairs over ESI static. There is no doubt about that. And within ESI static, you should prioritize economics wala chapters. But the next question is that should you leave complete entire ESI static undone? Is that the wise thing to do? That should not be done. It can be a costly mistake to completely leave ESI static. Why can it be a costly mistake? Nobody has stopped the examiner from asking you more static questions in the exam. So they can ask you more questions on any given year. So you should have at least some basic chapters of economics you should be very thorough with, so that if they start asking questions from there, then you should be able to answer those questions. Anchit sir told me one day, and I always remember this statement, that you have to fight for every mark. So always tell the student that there is a fight for every mark. So this idea of completely leaving ESI static is a very risky idea, because let us say that there are only 5 questions from ESI static of 2 marks, let us say, and there are only 10 marks worth of questions. So are you suggesting, are you ready to completely forego those 10 marks? Answer will be a straight away no. So what you should do is that do the priority chapters that I'm going to tell, that these are the priority chapters that you should do. Another reason why you should not leave complete static is that there can be questions from the interview.
right? The board can ask you questions about Indian economy. What are the present challenges? Why are the present challenges? How to go at, get ahead of the present challenges? So all these questions can be asked to you, and you need to have a good understanding of economics to be able to have a good discussion. I remember a story that one of my friends told me. One of my friends, he's working in DGFT, Directorate General of Foreign Trade and Ministry of Commerce. And he landed up in RBI interview. And that interview lasted for approximately 50 minutes. Why? Because the chairperson was really interested in discussing economics. My friend had a decent enough understanding of economics, of static as well as current. And he was able to hold a good discussion. He got very fantastic marks in the interview. Upwards of 42, 43 marks out of 50, which is fantastic marks, right? So if you can land yourself in that kind of an opportunity, that knowing the subject well, if you can hold a conversation, that will be always very helpful to you. So thoda bahut aapko padhna chahiye is my honest suggestion to you. Ab thoda bahut ke andar se kya padhna chahiye? What should be the specific chapter that you should study? Let us answer that question very quickly. Okay, please note down. Please write down. I always insist that you should write down growth and development, measurement of growth, national income and per capita income, a very important chapter which will teach you about GDP, NDP, national income, per capita income, difference between growth and development, a fantastic chapter which will give you a lot of basic understanding. Many students were asking, even we discuss internally, that if somebody wants to read these chapters from publicly available resources, so where should they read from? You can approach the 12th standard ka macroeconomics wala NCRT. In that you will find a very good coverage for this chapter. The next important chapter is monetary policy. In this chapter, you need to learn about the role of RBI, the role of monetary policy, the tools of monetary policy, CRR, SLR, repo rate, so on and so forth. What kind of monetary policy should be adopted so that we can tackle inflation? What kind of monetary policy should be adopted so that we can boost growth? This is also important. Even this chapter is covered in your macroeconomics wala NCRT, even this one is covered. Then your fiscal policy ka chapter, even this one is covered in your NCRT. In fiscal policy, we learn everything about government taxation, government revenue, government expenditure. We talk about capital expenditure, capital receipts, revenue expenditure, revenue receipts. All this is very interesting, very important. Why are these chapters important? Because most of the articles in newspaper, right, they are talking about India's growth rate. They're talking about how India can advance its GDP. They're talking about how the RBI can control inflation. They're talking about monetary policy. They're talking about fiscal deficit. So if you don't read these chapters, if you don't develop these concepts, then how in earth do you plan to understand those topics? You come across a lot of topics telling that India has been able to export more, India has been able to import less, India's current account deficit is going out of hand, a lot of foreign direct investment is coming into India, India's foreign exchange reserve is going up, it is going down. So everything that we discussed, that is discussed in this chapter on balance of payment. So if you read this chapter on balance of payment, you'll automatically be able to make sense of those newspaper articles. Then we read a lot about inflation. Whenever inflation goes out of hand, so we start comparing what is happening in wholesale price index, what is happening in consumer price index, what is happening in headline inflation, how to control inflation, why is inflation going up. So what I'm trying to tell you is that if you do these four, five important chapters, most important priority chapters, your understanding of current affairs will increase. Your ability to answer current affairs questions will increase. Your ability to hold a discussion in interview will increase. And these very important chapters can be very easily done through our concept notes, through our summary sheets, through our videos, right? So using these, you can develop your concepts, you can develop your understanding. Right? You can test your understanding through concept check and quiz, and then you can do all the revisions and tests. So in a very, very step-by-step manner, you can approach. And if you want to do all of this through a publicly available resource, 12th standard ka macroeconomics wala NCRT is my Bible. I really love the book and I would recommend it to anybody and for everybody. 100-150 rupay ki kitab hai. Bahut mast aap usko padh sakte hain, right? Of course, we have covered that book and many other books as a part of our course. That is your choice, right? Now, what about other chapters? So most important areas I have told you that they have to be covered. So your growth and development is, you cannot miss. Monetary policy, fiscal policy, inflation, balance of payment, you cannot miss. So apart from the above chapters, these chapters are also something that you can focus upon. These are the most important chapters. Now, apart from this, okay, there are many more chapters and they can be kept in phase two. They can be given priority level two. that once everything over here has been done, once your GA has been prepared, your QRE has been prepared, your computer knowledge has been prepared, your English has been prepared, your ARD has been prepared, about which Meena ma'am is going to talk about, and many people are, you know, really apprehensive about ARD. So once everything is done and, you know, you are sure that you have time in hand, then you can go for these chapters. Otherwise, what you can do is that you can just read the summary sheet related to these chapters. Upar se thoda bahut idea le liya, and then you can go. Because based upon the previous year trends, we are seeing that not many questions have been asked from static, first of all. So we need not really cram up everything. We can afford to do a little bit of smart work. And since everybody will be doing that, because we give the same suggestion to everybody, so you are safe if you are following our suggestion. What books should be read? Okay, there are many fat books available in the market. By God, and Economics and Political Weekly, something that if you start reading, you will have to sit with an Oxford dictionary, or you will have to call up Narveer sir, hai na? Because the paragraphs and the passages and the words, by God, they are complex, right? So if I were to request you to read one newspaper, okay, what you should do is that probably you can select one out of this. For my personal favorite, you know, is The Hindu. All said and done, it will never change, right? If you have to pick up one magazine to keep yourself updated, Yojana. But I would like to tell you that Ritika ma'am's current affairs team is taking care of all these sources also, but nevertheless, some primary reading is something that you can always do. So these books are suggested by the NABARD syllabus, by the notification that they release. And in my humble opinion, please don't waste any time on reading these books, right? Because they don't ask questions from these books. I don't know why they have mentioned these books. What you should do is that you should read the publicly available NCRTs from class 9th to class 12th, right? Read all the NCRTs, understand them, okay? Read the newspaper on a daily basis, and you will be on safe lines. This is what I want to say so far as these sources are concerned, so far as ESI static is concerned. So I hope that I have been able to address certain questions. Somebody asked that if they were to start ESI preparation today, can they complete it? Yes. Do the 5-6 important chapters that I have highlighted, okay? Read only the summary sheet, thoda thoda of the other chapters, and focus upon other areas of the examination, particularly current affairs. Current affairs is very important. Somebody asked me that how to answer non-contemporary questions that have been asked in ESI and ARD. By non-contemporary question, I am able to recall that in one of these examinations, they had suddenly started asking questions about Swarna Jayanti Gram Swarozgar Yojana. Okay, that was launched probably in 90s. Okay. I was reading class 9th NCRT today, you know, just to brush myself up. And I was seeing that in that 9th class NCRT, very nice small little paragraph has been given regarding Swarna Jayanti Gram Swarojgar Yojana. So do yourself a favor, okay? Read the NCRTs, okay? We'll focus upon that. That will give you a decent enough understanding. It will give you concept. It will give you Swarna Jayanti Gram Swarojgar Yojana. And if questions like those are asked, you'll be able to tackle. Otherwise, you should also be able to skip questions that you don't know the answers of. And it is okay to not know the answers of certain questions, because this is not an exam in which you have to score 200 out of 200 or 100 out of 100. You just have to clear the cutoff. So these are my answers to your questions, ma'am.
Thank you, sir, for such a detailed strategy you have shared, right? Although I have seen that you have answered this, but again, this question I have, this question is from Shubhaji. He's asking that can we leave other chapters and focus only on the priority chapters that you have said?
See, the point is that ideally speaking, do every chapter. Ideally speaking, do read everything. Ideally speaking, one should buy all the books that NABARD is suggesting and probably read them cover to cover. That is ideally. But that idealism is not going to land us anywhere, in my own opinion and what I have seen of the examination. So I would like to reiterate that learn to prioritize. See, there is always scarcity. The fundamental rule of economics is that there is scarcity. Fundamental rule of life is that there is scarcity. There is scarcity of water on earth. There is scarcity of food on earth. There is scarcity of time with you available on earth, especially if you're preparing for an exam, right? So when you have scarcity of time, you should allocate time, right? You should plan that how do you want to use your time? Can you ignore Vishnu sir's QRE? Probably not. You will not clear the cutoff. I'll be very disappointed. Can you ignore Narveer sir's English? You should not do that. Can you ignore current affairs? Can you ignore GK computer knowledge? You cannot do that. So please understand that you have only so much amount of time. and you have to allocate time to be able to derive the maximum possible value out of that time in terms of marks that you score in the examination. I'm shouting from the rooftop that they have not asked many questions from social issues wala chapter. What does that mean? Deprioritize it. Do it later. Time bache to karo, nahi time bache to right.
Sir, I did not want to say this, okay, but I cannot hold myself up from saying this, that there is scarcity, right? The fundamental concept of economics. Now, scarcity of oxygen also, is it?
So the point is that we need to plan. You need to plan in advance. See, the point is that there is always going to be scarcity. Tomorrow it may so happen that, you know, you are preparing for NABARD, right? And they may throw another notification on top of you. That can so happen, right? So you need to be prepared. You need to plan for all those things. And only then you can probably make the best. And you have to always remember that you are not the only one who are facing this problem. Okay. All students are in the same boat. So whoever is the smartest one over here who can maximize the value in terms of returns from the time invested, that person will be able to clear the cutoff. Keep that in mind.
Right. Ma'am. Thank you, sir. And I think that has cleared all your doubts, guys. The ESI static important chapters, what is the relevance, what you should ideally cover, what you should ideally not cover, and what you should practically cover, right? Everything has been discussed in detail with you by Avinash, sir, right? So I am getting here a few questions that please discuss important, because the time is probably, if exam takes place in the month of July, students are feeling that exam is, the time is less, right? But again, as sir said, if you prioritize, if you select the topics, Narveer sir has discussed topics with you. Veena ma'am has discussed topics that are very important. VD sir has given the topics. So if you prioritize, if you know the requirement of the examination, you can clear the examination, guys, right? So sir has given you the topics of ESI static, the important ones. Now we will move on to ARD part, right? ARD static topics, the right preparation approach, the right strategy, will be discussed by Veena ma'am. She is an expert of agriculture and rural development, I can say, right? So ARD for phase one and phase two is going to be discussed. Of course, it is an a common subject. So an integrated preparation is required. So Veena ma'am, please.
Thank you very much, Ritika ma'am. As yes, I can see lot of queries coming up from the students regarding ARD, how to prepare. Just give me 2 seconds. I'll start with this. See, friends, as I can see, first, no, the queries, as I have been noting down, the queries that are coming up, I could see here there are few students who are very much new to this. So I'll prioritize now this entire presentation on 4 major questions. First, what? What is the syllabus? Once you know about the syllabus, what are the important topics that you need to focus for both phase one as well as phase two? As you all know, ARD static or ARD as such is in both phase one and phase two. In phase two, 40 questions, 40 marks, of which again, it's a mix and match of static as well as current affairs. I'll be taking you through static and Ritika ma'am will later take you through current affairs. Phase two, similarly, 100 marks, 65 questions. And then again, it's again a mix of both ARD as well as ESI. ARD again, current affairs and static. I'll take you through ARD static. Now, once you answer this question, what is the syllabus? Next comes, what are the important topics? After that, why? Why only these important topics? Is there any proof or anything that can, you know, compensate or, you know, say that these are the important topics? Then comes how to cover these topics, what are the various concepts or how well you should go through, what are the various, you know, factors associated with that. Next comes is from where you need to go through this content. So I shall take you through each of these questions, one question at a time. First, what is the syllabus? This is the first question, and this should be the basic or the most important question. As you know, Avinash has sir has rightly said, you know, syllabus is one basic step, and you should remember the syllabus thoroughly. Only then you'll be able to understand the concepts and you'll be able to relate to them, because most of these concepts are in such a way that you'll come about them in current affairs as well. So until and unless you'll have a thorough knowledge or idea of the syllabus, it would be very difficult, you know, for preparation. So these are the various topics, as you can see, and syllabus, no need to worry. NABARD has already provided us a prescribed syllabus. Since agriculture is a very vast subject, you know, without syllabus, it would be very difficult to prepare. So here we are very safe, happy. NABARD has given the syllabus, and these are the topics that I have given here. These are the various topics that you can see, you know, as part of the syllabus. Now, again, you'll ask me, see, ma'am, there's so many topics, such vast subject. What are the topics that one needs to focus, and why? Why only those topics? See, for that, you have seen the syllabus. There are various topics, you know, agriculture, agronomy, horticulture, animal husbandry, poultry, fisheries, forestry, so many. Once you are done it, next comes is, what are the important topics? See, friends, based on the previous year questions analysis since the past few years, it has been observed that these few are the very, very important topics that you need to focus. And they are horticulture, animal husbandry and poultry, soils. Soils again includes all related to soils, soil conservation, what are the various factors associated with the formation of the soils, and then fertilizers, what are the type of, you know, fertilizer management, everything, all that will be part of soils. Next is agronomy. Agronomy, field crops, what are the various steps that are associated with agronomy, because it itself is a, you know, huge sub-discipline of agriculture. So we have seen that these four topics, they are the ones, questions from these topics are asked, you know, on a constant basis. So that's the reason you should be going through these first. I'm not saying that you should leave the other topics, but you should first go through these, and the basics, you know, the basic first chapter that you need to go through is agronomy and field crops. So once you are done with this, you'll get, you know, what are the various steps that, you know, crop raising or agriculture is based, that you'll get here. After that, you know, you can go through the other topics one at a time. So other than this, it's not that only these four are important. There are various, you know, few important topics as well, I can say, like agricultural engineering, agrometeorology, seeds, and irrigation management. Irrigation, these are the few other topics that you can focus. And this is for phase one. Now you'll ask me, what are the topics that are important for phase two? For this, you need to understand, you know, the what are the questions that are asked in phase one, how they are asked. Let's see that. See, friends, it has been observed that whatever the questions that, that were asked in phase one from whatever the topics, the questions in phase two are asked from the same topics. As you can see here, this is that's the reason I have taken up with, I'm trying here to explain this with the help of a graph. See, this orange one, it denotes, questions that were asked in prelims. And the blue one from mains. As you can see, whatever the topics from which questions were asked in phase one, from the same topics, questions are asked in phase two as well. You know, it has been observed that on an average, at least 70% of the topics that are, you know, covered in phase one, the same topics, you know, questions from the same topics would be asked in phase two. So this is the, you know, ARD static part in, 2019. As you can see, 14 questions were asked in mains and 17 questions, 17 out of 40. Here, 14 out of 33 questions were asked, of which 14 were from static. So of that 14 also, most of them were asked from the same topics. That's the reason whatever topics that I have mentioned, a couple of minutes back, now, based on the phase one strategy, that four chapters, very, very important. The other chapters, whatever that might be asked, or the other topics from where the questions are asked in phase one, you can focus on phase two. So this is how you need to strategize, or, you know, this is the link, as you can see, you can establish a link between phase one and phase two. Based on that, you can strategize, or you can smart work your preparation. Similar, you know, I can show one more instance in 2020. See that the inference was that the same topics questions are asked. static, especially static phase one, static phase two. Now in ARD, again in 2020, we could see that 20 questions were from prelims, 20 were from current affairs and 24 were from static. But when we moved on to, you know, mains, only 5 were from current affairs, but 18 questions were from static. This might be because, you know, most of the times, you know, the questions from current affairs would be on huge number in ARD. But yes, this time what happened is there was a huge gap between prelims and mains for 2020. This might be the reason that they could have given, you know, or asked more questions from static. But generally the trend is more current affairs, more than 50%, almost 60% would be from current affairs and 40 to 50% would be from static. This is what the general trend is. So as you can see here, again, the same thing, the blue mains, orange prelims from 2020. All the questions I have enumerated here. See, you know, the same, whatever the topics that are, that were, you know, the questions that were asked from those topics, the same topics, you know, the questions from the same topics were asked in phase two. But here there's a, you know, this one small catch here. As you can see, this agro irrigation, agrometeorology, fisheries, you know, you can see that questions were asked from these chapters in prelims, but questions from these topics were not asked in mains in static. But questions from current affairs from these topics were asked. So again, you can infer two things from here. So whatever the questions that are asked in phase one or the topics, you can say that, you know, questions from the topics, you know, questions from those topics, especially current affairs, you know, questions can be asked based on current affairs, like here irrigation. There was a static question in prelims, but when we moved to phase two, questions from were asked from the irrigation topic, but yes, from current affairs. They asked some data-based questions from the latest whatever report that was released at that time. So these are the two inferences that you can see. So here we have seen what's the syllabus, what are the important topics, how to strategize between the phase one and phase two. Now we'll see how to prepare or how to cover these concepts or how to cover these topics. Now, as I have mentioned, you know, there are few chapters, no doubt in that, you can focus on that and you can very well get through the cutoff, no doubt. That will be really helpful to you, you know. But yes, you know, we don't know, since, you know, the last year also we have seen that, though generally current affairs questions are asked in a huge number, but because of various situations or circumstances, questions from static were asked more. So it's better to go through all the chapters, but yes, try to cover the important, very, very important and important chapters first, then you can give time for the rest of the chapters. As Avinash sir has rightly said, if there is no time, you can at least go through the summary sheets and quizzes so that you'll have a fair idea when, you know, questions from those topics are asked in the exam. Two, see, generally I you know, get questions from student, ma'am, I'm from non-agri student, I'm not able to understand the concepts, not able to retain or remember. So now the best thing I can suggest to them is whenever you go through any concept of agriculture, try to focus on the keywords. See, for example, if there's a classification of you know, field crops, there are so many classifications based on climate, based on, so you know, the root depth, based on, you know, economic use of the plant, etc., etc. So whenever you come across any concept, try to focus on the keywords. For example, you know, depth of the root, or you know, based on the season. Based on the season, there are temperate crops, there are tropical crops, there are subtropical crops. When you take up temperate, try to focus on the keywords. What are the temperatures that are required? And then what are the areas where these fall? So focus on the keywords. Then focus on examples of every topic. See the same temperate example, if you know what, you know, go through the classification temperate. So you need to understand the concept, the keywords. Then you should try to understand what are the various examples that come under that. At least 2 to 3 examples you need to know. And that too, whatever the common ones are there, you can remember those, because that's what generally asked in the exam. They don't try to go deeper into that. So whenever you go through any concept, stress on the keywords, examples of every topic. And simple questions. Mostly in phase one, the questions are always simple, straight. So you need not dig deeper into the topic. For phase two, you'll have some applied questions, some, you know, concept, you know, little bit in depth, you know, the concept, in depth concept based questions. But yes, once you are through with phase one and we have the list of topics from which questions were asked, we will we'll go through those topics, you know, in detail in phase two. In anyway, since the syllabus for both phase one and phase two are same, more than 60-70% of the preparation is already done. So the rest of the whatever the, you know, applied sort of questions or in depth, little bit in depth concepts of the same topics, it would be easy for us to go through. Next, whatever, you know, the current affairs related, for example, Avinash sir has also rightly said for ESI, it's the same thing. Whenever there are few concepts or you know, anything that is related to current affairs, unless you understand that, you know, static part, it would be difficult for you to answer the current affairs related questions. You know, for example, there are various crops. You know, there are various varieties that are released or various breeds of animals. Until and unless you understand what are the basics of that, like, you know, for example, if there is a breed, it has some characteristics. You know, if you know or there is anything that is related to that particular breed in animal husbandry in current affairs, without the knowledge of those characteristics, it would be very difficult for you to understand. Two, see, there are so many, you know, institutes or, you know, so many crop related news that come in the current affairs. So whenever there is any crop, any animal, anything, you know, that comes in the current affairs, try to correlate that with the static part. If, for example, there's something, you know, news on mango or something, try to see what are the, you know, institutes that are working for this development of mango. There's some news on avians or birds. Try to see what are the various institutes that are related to that birds. What are the various, you know, syllabus, what are the topics that are, you know, that are associated with those topic in the syllabus as prescribed by NABARD. Try to correlate that with the syllabus, that then it would be easy for you to remember. Next, acronyms. Whenever you are going through static part, there are, you know, sometimes many acronyms. Along with that, if there are any schemes, any technological missions related to ARD, which Ritika ma'am will be taking you through in some time from now, you need to focus on the acronyms, abbreviations. At least one or two questions would be asked from this. And second important point, one more important point related to this. See, there are various revolutions, agriculture revolutions, and there are various fathers of disciplines. At least one or two questions are asked, you know, from this topic. So kindly go through that. And whenever, you know, as I've mentioned earlier also, whenever there is a mention of any crop, any animal, try to see that what are the various institutes or organizations that are working for the welfare of them or for any research and development purpose. So these are the various, you know, points that you need to focus. After this, see, once you are done with 70% of the syllabus, try to do as many mock tests as possible. Once you are done with 70% of the static syllabus, give one mock test. With this, you know, you'll have two important points. One, see, you'll have an understanding of what are the strengths, how much you are able to retain, what are your strength points, what are your weak points, and based on that, you can do your revision or go through that particular topic again. Two, see, this will help you to overcome the examination blues or the examination fever. Sometimes, you know, I hear a lot of times that students say, no, I have gone through this entire topic, it was very easy, but once I went to the exam, I couldn't recollect that. You know, to avoid that, give as many mock tests as possible so that this can be avoided. So your brain will get tuned to that stress situation and it would be very easy to overcome them once you go through the live examination. Two, go through the previous year questions. See, whatever analysis I have given, it's completely based on the previous year questions only. So try to go through whatever previous year questions that are there, especially for the past 4 years, at least 17, 18, 19, 20, that will really give you a good insight of, you know, what kind of questions are asked. Whatever the analysis that is based till now, that's completely based on that only. And it's logical also. It's completely, you have, you know, black and white in black and white in front of you. And it's logical as well. So these are the few points. Now, where I can go through the content. We have seen what, why, how. Now we'll see where. See, these are the various books that can be prescribed or that can be gone through for ARD static. Once again, friends, you please do not go read, you know, cover to cover. Selective reading should be done. For that, you need to have good understanding of the syllabus. If you have that syllabus in your mind, it would be easy for you to go through that concepts in the, from these particular books, because we can't suggest only one book for the entire static subject, because the various topics are covered in various books. For example, if animal husbandry is there, it's covered very beautifully in this book, a textbook of animal husbandry by G.C. Banerjee. You'll not get that much content in any of the other books. Similarly, Fundamentals of Agriculture, it's very good, you know, it is by Arun Katyayan. Again, one good book. If you want to, you know, to go through the basics of each of the concepts that are present in the, you know, given in the syllabus, you can go through this Agriculture at a Glance by R.K. Sharma. And for Agriculture Engineering, if you want to go through, for especially for phase two, this would be very helpful, Elements of Agriculture Engineering by Dr. Jagadishwar Sahai. Gloucester's Horticulture for Horticulture. And Nemraj Sunda, competitive book of agriculture by Nemraj Sunda. This is generally for revision purpose. Once you are done with all the, you know, gone through the syllabus and everything, this would help you in revising the concepts, because most of the content that is present in this book is in bullet points. So after that, if you still, you know, you don't have book, or if you still want to go through any concept or the latest updates of that particular concept, you can always Google, and ICAR is the best source. See, I have seen that students, telling about TNA is best site and various other sites. But generally, it has been observed that few concepts which are on a national level, that is very good when it comes to that. But when there are few things, like, for example, very recently I got a query from a student that, you know, in a TNA site, they have given that the period, that is the intercalving interval. So that is different. The figures are different from ICAR or NDDB and TNAU. But since NDDB is completely into this animal husbandry, this part only, better get such kind of details from that specific site. And TNAU, it's very good for other content which are completely on a national, like dryland agriculture or vermicomposting. That's almost similar for the entire India. But for others, you need to understand. So I suggest you to go through ICAR, which is one of the best sources for agriculture, whatever updates you want. So friends, this is all from my end. Hope I was able to make a point here in, you know, getting, you know, that link between especially phase one and phase two, and how to go through the syllabus for phase one especially. So Ritika ma'am, over to you again.
Thank you so much, Veena ma'am. And I must say that you have answered a lot of queries in between itself, because I could see students were asking, this is an apprehension in the students, that what if I am not from non-agriculture background, right? What if I am from agriculture background, should I go in more depth? Or what if I have never studied agriculture, what do I do? So I think you have told many important things, that if you, the keywords you have given us, then you have told that phase one and phase two are interrelated. So I think that is going to answer those questions. But would you like to add anything specifically for the non-agri background students?
See, Ritika ma'am, see friends, you know, this is the notion that, you know, if I'm from a non-agri background, I'll not be able to understand the concepts. or I'll not be able to clear the exam. See, whatever the ARD concepts or whatever the syllabus that has been prescribed by NABARD for ARD, you know, it's all basics only that you need to go through. And as I mentioned earlier also, that is what that it takes to clear phase one. Yes, for phase two, you need to have, you know, a little bit, you know, in-depth understanding of few topics, but yes, based on the topics that are covered in phase one, we'll go through, you know, those topics in depth for phase two. But otherwise, try to focus on the basic concepts, try to, you know, go through, you know, in breadth, but not in depth. That would really help you for ARD static in phase one. And this is applicable for non-agri students as well. As I mentioned, focus on the keywords, basics, examples, very helpful for you to get through.
Right, ma'am, right. So on that note, you have mentioned about phase one, right? The importance of the ARD and how to cater to both the phases together. Right. I would just like to mention one very important point here, guys. When we talk about phase one, now, because we are done with the strategy of almost all important things that are covered in phase one, except for current affairs part that I'll be sharing shortly. But because we have discussed all these subjects, Naveer sir, BD sir, Veena ma'am, Avinash sir, everyone has told you what all things you need to cover for phase one. Please note, sectional cutoff shall not be your only hurdle that you want to clear just sectional cutoff. Please remember that. Okay, it might be in the case that because you're very weak or you do not have time at all for, let's say, quant reasoning, there it might be the case that you can just clear the cutoff, right? But you should always target higher. Let me tell you, ESI and ARD, together these three subjects are of 100 marks in your phase one. And students are there who have scored more than 85 plus marks in this particular section only from phase one. They just clear the cutoff, okay? This, I think we faculty members have discussed this many times that, you know, you can divide your preparation for phase one. QRE, computers at one side, GAESI, ARD at one side. One of these, if you put in the balance, the weighing measure thing, then one thing has to be heavy. You have to score high in at least out of these two sets one. Either you go good for, if you are good in quant reasoning, let's say English, you have been preparing for banking examinations, go for it. Score high in quant reasoning, English, and of course computers, and then you can balance your GA, ESI, ARD. But that is not very helpful in phase two, because of course these subjects, ESI, ARD, are going to be repeated in phase two. So please just remember this thing that you have to clear the cutoff overall, but sectional cutoff is just for your own sake to keep a hurdle. Just, you know, you have this thing in mind that I'll clear this cutoff and that's it. No, that is not the right approach. And this is doable if you follow the right strategy. If you do this SWOT analysis, as I think Naveen sir used this word, SWOT, strength weakness analysis, if you are able to do that, I am good in, let's say, computers, I am good in GA, and I am good in English. So take that subject high, okay, and balance out other subjects. This you have to do for phase one at least, right? Coming back, Veena ma'am, I'll just summarize 2-3 points what you have mentioned so that students, those who are still asking questions, or they can, those who have joined just now, because I can see students are probably late in joining, so they are asking this. So ma'am, what I could understand is that in ARD, be it phase one, phase two, current, like in ESI, current plays a major role, but due to any external anomaly, let's say, static is also now playing a very important role. The weightage is of static also now, especially with the 2020 paper. So we should do static also really well. We should give due importance to both static and current. One, this thing I have noted down. Then you have said that topics that are asked in phase one are going to be helpful. The same topics are going to be helpful for phase two also. So this also students have to keep in mind that the questions might be easy in nature in phase one, but on the same topic, an in-depth question can be asked in phase two, right? This I could make out, ma'am, from your strategy which you have shared. Right, so thank you. Veena, ma'am, anything else you'd like to add?
No, ma'am. Once you are done, you know, anyways, queries are coming, then I will be able to know answer more you know, questions. If I have missed out on anything based on the queries, I can answer.
Great. Thank you. So now, guys, moving on to your current affairs of ASI ARD together, right? Although the base has been laid by Avinash Sabina, ma'am, I'll just share the most important things that you need to cover. Then we will move on to a very, I would say, most demanding subject, English descriptive by Narveer sir, right? And then we will take up your queries before ending the session. Okay. So guys, let me take you to my screen. So let's talk about ESI first, right? Okay. So here I have done this cutoff thing for you. The analysis of cutoff is here. See, you can see the cutoff, sectional cutoff this is. Okay. Right. So this is the cutoff for phase one, not phase two. Okay. Phase two is ESI ARD combined paper that I'll share at the end. So 2020, 2019, 2018. The cutoff has been decreasing, if you see, right, in ESI. You can see the cutoff 5.7532. But as I said, are you going to restrict yourself to this cutoff? If you do, you'll not be able to clear the overall cutoff. You'll just be sticking to these two or three marks, okay? So from these numbers, what I want to tell you is just that you have to be generally aware about things. But if you want to clear the examination, of course, you have to have the in-depth knowledge of the examination, right? So guys, the important thing for ESI current affairs, I want to tell you, phase one and phase two, in both the phases, it plays an important role, right? We have seen that in phase one, 25 to 30 questions out of 40 marks are from ESI current affairs, as Avinash sir already mentioned this thing, right? In phase two also, out of 65 questions, 30 to 35 questions are from current affairs. Now, this is the general trend. I am not saying that this is going to be the trend for all the upcoming years examination. Rather, this is an average of the previous years, right? One more thing I would like to address. I was seeing one student was asking, ma'am, what is the marking scheme of these 65 questions? Like marks 100, question 65. So my dear students, 30 questions are there, one marker, 35, two markers. So 35 into 2 is 70, 30 into 1 is 30. So 100 marks are there out of 65 questions, ESI ARD combined, right? So you can see that ESI current affairs hold a very high weightage, be it phase 1, be it phase 2. Of course, you must have basic knowledge, the understanding of the concepts, inflation, what is inflation, although in paper, there is less probability that a direct question on inflation would be there, but that does not mean it cannot be there, okay? So you have to understand the concepts and then relate to the current affairs. Your current affairs would become easy for you if you are aware about static part. Okay, what is the, rather than just knowing the figure, this is the retail inflation right now, this is the WPI right now. If you understand what is inflation, of course it is easy, right? As so many examples have already been given. So the topics for phase two I have given here, these are of course going to be relevant for phase one also. There cannot be separate preparation for phase one and phase two. Union budget latest, the year I have mentioned here, union budget, economic survey, for any year you prepare, the latest which is available at that time. Reports by national and international bodies released in past 1 year. So timeline, you have been asking that, ma'am, what should be the timeline? Ideally 1 year. They will not go beyond 1 year, okay? But what if you have started preparing right now? You will not be able to cater to 1 year completely, right? So in that case, stick to 6 months, half of 1 year. That is the most feasible thing that you can do, right? Government schemes, guys, newly launched schemes in past 1 year and the old schemes in news in past 1 year. So old scheme, Avinash has given this example of Swarn Jayanti Rozgar Yojana, right? So although that is a very important flagship scheme of the government mentioned in your static part also, but please understand whatever flagship schemes, MG Narega, Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana, Midday Meal, these are the schemes which are important. That is why they are running till date. They are in news for one or the other reason. Either some update has taken place, some budgetary allocation has been made, or some target that has been met, or they have set the target. So old schemes which are in news. It will be easy for you to identify the important schemes, right? Related to your syllabus, have a good knowledge of your syllabus. Then schemes, those are in news again and again. You just mark those as important, okay? You have to cover them because if government is doing something on those schemes, that means it is important. And if it is related to your syllabus, if it is related to, let's say, education, health, agriculture, employment generation, let's say, environment, all these things are going to be very important for your examination. So these topics are very, very important. I am saying very, very important. That means you should not miss these topics. Now, there are some important topics, not very, very, if we go by priority, but these you should cover, right? Because probable questions are asked from these topics. That is SCCC 2011. SCCC and census are released every 10 years. So guys, please understand this is released. This is of the year, base year of 2011 this is, but this was not released in 2011. It will be probably released after 2 years of it. So don't worry that what if I prepare SCCC 2011 and in 2020 government is going to release another SCCC. Government is not going to do that, okay, right now. The base year is 2021. It will be released after 2 years. Or if the government decides that now we are up and running, we want to really release it, then also at least 2022 it will be there, okay? So cover these. Do not be in this confusion that what if I cover it? Because I've seen you are confused that what if I cover it and it is not asked, right? Then there is general current affairs related to the syllabus of ESI. For this syllabus of ESI, you have to find out. We have shown you in the PPT also, download the syllabus and any development going on related to your syllabus, you must cover. Now, what is the timeline? My dear friends, the timeline to cover current affairs has to be 1 year, right? But latest 6 to 8 months before the examination are very important. Again, why very important? Because majority of the questions are going to be from 6 to 8 months, right? If you have been preparing, let's say from past year, okay, you have covered really well, just do the revision and keep in mind that 6 to 8 months are going to be very important. But if you're starting right now, what is the key? Cut off 1 year divided by 2, 6 months. Do your 6 months preparation really well, but then you have to know stakes are high. You cannot just read 6 months current affairs. You cannot miss out any question from current affairs from 6 months. Then this is your responsibility, right? So all the important things that constitute your current affairs are here in front of you. Majorly, if I say, we always say this, right, Avinash sir, that pillars of ESI, current affairs are reports, schemes, and your current affairs. I think you would agree with that. Right? So,
right, ma'am.
Now, thank you. So now, what are the sources? Now, we are providing a comprehensive magazine covering all the current affairs that are required for the examination. Right? You can just rely on that magazine. We have been able to produce highest questions from that magazine from past many years. But what if you do not have the course of editor? Guys, these are the sources in front of you. The most relevant sources, tested and tried sources. The question can be mapped to these sources if you feel it feasible that you cover PIB, you can cover PIB. The Hindu is important. Hindu business line, because Hindu business line caters to your agri economy, right? Economic Times is going to cater to your general awareness. Enlivenment, of course, your financial awareness, which is of course a part of ESI again. So these are the sources you must cover for at least 3 months. If you say that I do not have any other source, I do not have time, okay, then also you can prepare. Stick to PIB, stick to any of the newspaper given here for 3 months. Make your notes. It is going to be a very gigantic task, I would say, but you can do if you do not have any other thing, right? And I've already told you, magazine is there for you if you have the course. Everything there, each and every source, nothing else you need to cover. Okay, so now taking you to guys another important part, ARD current affairs. Veena ma'am has shed a lot of light on the ARD current affairs and static weightage. So cut off for phase one, you see 2018 4 5 1. Now again, I would say these are just numbers for you to make yourself assured that yes, I can clear the cutoff. Even if I am from non-agri background, it is easy for me to score this much marks. Given we have given you so much guidance, Veena ma'am has shared so much with you on ARD. If you prepare that, guys, you can easily clear this sectional cutoff and you can score really high on that. Okay. But as I said, this is not your only hurdle. We have to clear the overall hurdle. So to give you an analysis of the weightage of ARD current affairs, 50-50 weightage we can give actually. Whatever ARD questions are there, how many ever questions are there, 50-50 to current and static, we can divide on an average, right? In the past years, static was asked less, but from 2020, static is also being asked long. So just prepare both things really well. Topics have been shared with you on static part by Veena, right? Now I will share with you the things that you need to cover for ARD current. I have a long list, but trust me, it is going to be worthy. Each and everything is going to fetch you marks if you cover. Because again, I'm telling you, tested and tried topics, every year question is there from these topics. Not one, not two. Each, every topic you see here, the question is going to be there. Agri census, livestock census, the latest one. These are again released every 5 years. So the ones that are available right now, 2015-16 agri census is there. Right, livestock census is also there, cover that, okay? Handloom census is there. Latest MSPs, latest means the ones released just in the month of examination or 1 month before that. So MSPs of all the important crops, latest advance estimates that are released. So agriculture handbook, handbook of horticulture, then fishery statistics, so yearly data. Question is there usually, and students really find it difficult to answer because they don't know what is the source of it. So guys, this is the source. Where to cover it? Go to the website of the ministry directly. You will find it. If you do not want to do that, you have the course, rely on the PDFs that we are providing you. Everything will be there, right? There is schemes related to agriculture and allied sectors and rural development. This I have written here specifically because we have seen agri-related schemes are asked a lot nowadays in examination. Keep this in mind, be it old scheme, be it a flagship scheme, be it a new scheme. If you see any scheme in news related to agriculture sector, allied sector, fishery sector, rural development, Pradhan Mantri Gram Sadak Yojana, or Sansad Adarsh Gram Yojana, you have to cover that, right? Latest state of forest report, NABARD annual report, yes, and annual reports of ministries of agriculture, rural development, later.
I think that we have lost ma'am's connection. And so let us continue the discussion ahead until ma'am joins us. So Narveer sir, I guess that we have to still talk about descriptive English part. There are many students who are having a lot of queries such as, you know, how to avoid typo errors, what are the kind of sources that they should read, what is the marks distribution, how should they prepare. So I would request you to please address these queries and let us take the session ahead.
Right, sir. Thank you so much, sir. So guys, moving on to the section of descriptive English, which is very crucial to crack your phase two. Because you very well know that 100 marks are for ARD and ESI, and the rest 100 marks are allocated to descriptive English. So guys, there are certain things that I really, really wish to stress upon. So guys, just let me share my screen with you, and I'll be able to help you out with most of your queries, guys. So here it goes, guys. This is the strategy for NABARD Grade A Phase 2 for descriptive English part. So guys, I would take all your queries, and I would try to answer all your doubts and your queries as we move along the session. But let's just understand the basics of the paper. So guys, it's a 100 mark paper, which is descriptive English, and you would be allocated 90 minutes to finish the paper. Now, the core syllabus of this paper has been in the previous years. You are asked to write an essay of your choice out of the five given topics or four given topics. Now, then you are given a passage to make a precis, to draft a precis on. Then there is a passage for your comprehension questions. So you have to comprehend the whole passage and write down your answers elaboratively. And the fourth part is, which is quite unique looking at these exams, which is business or office correspondence, which means either a letter or a report. So guys, what are they basically testing you on are these four core skills: your articulation, your drafting skills, your language and vocabulary, and the structure. So I would like to emphasize on all the four parts. But before that, guys, I would like you to ask yourself this question. Why do they ask you to, why do they make you write these answers? Why do they make you type these answers? I mean, what do they really want to test? Just your language? Many students or many aspirants believe that this is only a test of English language. But please, guys, please remember, this is not just about your English. Yes, English is the cornerstone of this paper. But you have to understand now, these questions are not your everyday, you know, your day-to-day questions that you come across. You don't have to write an essay every day. Avinash, sir, I think you agree with me, right? So a student...
No, sir, you don't have to write an essay every day.
Right.
But you should write it on some days.
Yes. So somebody was asking me, sir, is writing 2 essays per week, is it good? So I would say, yes, it is good enough for now. But after you're done with your phase one, then I would think that you should probably write more than that. But no, what I'm getting at is the psychology behind the questions. So guys, why are they asking you to write an essay? Why are they asking you to draft a pressy therein where you also have to comprehend the passage and then draft your answers for reading comprehension? And then you have to write either a letter or a report. So basically, guys, this would be your day-to-day work life when you actually join NABARD as an officer. So, you would probably receive reports from the government or other bodies, and your superiors or your seniors would ask you to make a pressy, summarize those reports. So that is the point of asking you to make these answers there. Why do they want you to write an essay? Because they want to see your articulation skills, your ideology, your knowledge base. So, and obviously your control of the language is the crux of all that. So basically, guys, this is all about your office correspondence. You will have to write or you may have to revert to the letters that you receive while you are working as a NABARD officer, right? You have to read reports and comprehend them and then present your opinions on the same. So guys, once you understand the psychology behind the paper, now that would make you actually ready for your descriptive English portion. So guys, there are 4 questions that are being asked in this paper and you have 90 minutes. And guys, the challenge is not just to write, but to write well. You know why? Let's say the essay, usually essays for 350 words. The word limit for essay is 350 words. Right, for Prezi, if I remember correctly, last time in 2020, the word limit was 150 words. For reading comprehension, they don't ask you to, they actually do not assign you any word limit, but it has to be usually, there are 3 questions and you have to actually write about 80 to 100 words for every answer. That means somewhat around 250 to 260 words. And then there was a letter which was to be written. You won't believe me, the letter was to be written in 250 words. So if you add up the whole list, so guys, can you understand how much you have to actually type? Not write, guys, please understand, you have to type your answers on an interface which would be new to you. So guys, in the paper, you would be given your topics. Under that topic, there would be a dialogue box and you would have to write your answers in that dialogue box, which makes it really difficult to scroll up and down and then push into it. So 350 plus 150, that makes it 500, then 250 for letter, 750, and then probably 250 for RC. So that makes it around 1,000 words. So guys, can you understand this? This is simple mathematics here. So within 90 minutes, you have to type 1,000 words, right? So first thing is you should get going from today onwards. You should have a habit of typing. every alternate day, at least sit down on your PC and write down something, type down anything that you come across. Even if it's an essay, write down it, write it down. And then, you know, just see how much time you take. Then if you read a good article that day, try to make a pressy out of it. So that would help you with your typing speed. So within those 90 minutes, guys, you'll have to type around 1,000 words. And these 1,000 words can't be meaningless. You know, they can't be, they can't be out of the context. So that's where I would like to stress the second part. So first of all, guys, you should start preparing for your typing speed, because I see every year many students tell me that they were not able to finish the paper on time. That is the biggest concern that we come across. Right, guys? So start practicing. From today onwards, give it time, because you know this speed and this efficiency and accuracy, you know, typing without making typos, that takes time. So start typing from today onwards, and I will come to the point what to type. Now, somebody was, I think Shiv was asking me, sir, is there a chance that they could change the syllabus? Now, guys, for descriptive English, I don't think there is a chance of any change, because they would actually prescribe you before the paper. So when the notification would be out, you would be exactly told what questions would be put to you. So you don't have to worry about that. And in the past, so many years we have seen, they have not changed the syllabus for descriptive English part. Now, what could be a difference? Now, the difference could be the word limit. For example, the letter that they gave in 2020, letter was never given for 250 words before that year. It always used to be for 150 words. So students were very surprised that what to write in a letter. Right. So first of all, you need to understand the structure, the drafting skills required, and the typing speed required. Now, moving on to how to prepare for these sections. Now, guys, first and the foremost, as I even stressed upon while discussing phase one, start reading editorials. You know, reading editorials, it's not just something that would help you in your drafting. It would also, as all my respected teachers, my colleagues told you, that editorials, you know, they keep you updated. The first and foremost part is they keep you updated with current affairs and whatever is going on around you, right? Second, while you read editorials, try to select editorials which could be, you know, selectively related to this paper. You know what I'm talking about? Any topic that is based on ARD and ESI. Guys, the farm laws, the recently amended farm laws, right? You remember, have you read thoroughly the farm, what, you know, APMCs are, what farm laws, you know, what were the changes made in the farm laws? Why is there a protest which is going on against these farm laws? So rather than making your opinion without, you know, without looking at the facts and statistics, do not do that, because this will, you know, this will show when you write your answers in your essay writing. So have facts with you to support your theories. So always read articles based on ARD, ESI, current affairs, and specifically economic issues as well. That I can say, you know, specifically related to economics and specifically rural economics of the country, which is very, very important right now. You know, this may include a topic on Ayushman Yojana. This may include, why has India faced, or why has India been struck the worst by the second wave of COVID-19? So what would you write, guys, if I ask you to write an essay on that particular topic right now? Now, do you think that you are ready to write down 350 words on the go? So this is what we call preparation, guys. So read editorials so that you can collect. Now, guys, remember these five things. These are very, very important. Facts, statistics, data, reports by any organization, be it NSSO, be it Niti Aayog, or be it any government or any private organization. But you must remember specific reports. And then last, you must remember important schemes. Now, guys, this is what I call pre-preparation. Now, guys, last year, I remember many students were, many students asked me, sir, for example, the topic that was thrown at the aspirants was to double farmers' income by 2022. Now, guys, you must have read a lot about doubling farmers' income by 2022. But the point is, typing your essay under pressure, now that takes a lot. So what I would suggest to you is, you know, you should be smart enough to prepare for your essays beforehand. And how to prepare for your essays beforehand? Do this. Now, collect these five things and remember this. And you know, you don't have to actually work anything out of the way. When you're reading or when you're preparing for your ARD, ESI, or your static and current affairs part, you must come across all these data and schemes. So try writing them down. Try to remember them so that, you know, what happens when you are drafting your essay in the actual paper. Now, this would really help you. Now, how it would help you? It would help you in three good ways. Number one, it would save your time. Right, guys, you agree with me? Because, you know, when you already know facts and data about a particular topic, now you would be ready with your introduction. You would be ready with most portion of your essay. Number one, it would save your time. Number two, it would fetch you more marks. So guys, many students ask me, sir, is it okay to start your essay with some quotation from some famous personality? Avinash sir, back me on this. So please, guys, you judge on your own self. Now, if I start my essay by saying this, that Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru or let's say Mahatma Gandhi believed that if the farmers of a country are poor, the country can never prosper. Now, this is a very psychological opening. On the other hand, if I start my essay on this point like this, that even after 70 years of independence, more than 64% of the population is directly or indirectly dependent on the agrarian economy of the country. But the contribution of the agriculture sector to the GDP is only 16%. Now, guys, which opening sounded better to you? Now, this is what we call smart work. You don't have to sit there, think of your opening. You can start your essays with such impactful, such punchy openings that the invigilator is forced to read your answers and he would be forced to, score you good marks. Avinash, sir, what's your take on this?
Sir, I would like to give you an example to give my take. Like, for example, the issue of poverty, which is a major socioeconomic challenge. So, if you go through the NCERT books, right, in the book, they have written a line that Mahatma Gandhi said that if there is abject poverty in the country, we have not truly won our independence, something on these lines. Right. Then there are many stories which have been very thoroughly narrated that what is urban poverty, and they've given actual examples. So if you could start with a quote, or you could start with a short story also to depict very clearly, probably you are the better judge over here. It can help in drawing in the attention of the examiner in a very systematic manner, depending upon what the story is and whether it is related to the topic in a relevant manner or not, sir.
Absolutely, sir. That is what I actually wanted to stress upon, guys. You have a specific word limit, 350 words or 300 words, and you have to utilize that word limit. So you have to act smart. And I would also like to like Ritika ma'am and Veena ma'am to join in. And, you know, what I was talking about is it not, it's a win-win situation for everyone. Whatever you read in your ARD, ESI and current affairs, you can use the same information, you can use the same data to frame your essays in your descriptive English. So guys, in a way, you're actually preparing for both the exams. Ma'am, Ritika, ma'am, what do you say?
Oh, sir, definitely this is going to be there because we have seen that in English, essays are going to be around topics which are related to, let's say, ESI, right, economy. Even for that matter, the hot topics that are going on. So English is to be there. A structure has to be there. As you always tell students, that follow the structure. Intro should be there. Body should be there. Inclusion. But the content, that from where will you get? Right? You cannot. There is an rural poverty. Right? If an essay is there, but you are able to put current examples, current schemes that are being run by the government. So that will give you the punch. The examiner will get to know that you do not only know the English, the structure to follow, but you also know, you are well aware about the current scenario going on in the country. So of course, this is going to help. And I would think, Veena ma'am, this is the same case for agriculture also, because agriculture again is a part of economy, right?
Right, ma'am. Just like, you know, bolte hai na ki tadka lagana type ka. So that ARD static will add, to that part. So yes, a little bit of ARD static, and as you have said, whatever the current affairs, you know, that are related, that would be highly important. Structure, as mentioned by Avinash sir, very, very important. And last, the tadka part would be from ARD static, because I have seen that not only in, you know, this year, you know, while I was taking interview of various students, you know, the 2020 NABARD graded students, this is what they have mentioned. You know, they, it this not only in this and English descriptive part, but interviews also, this would really help them.
Right.
Absolutely. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. So basically, guys, this is our opinion as a team that you, you know, you have to stand out when you're drafting your answers. And the only way to stand out is to impress the invigilator, or you're basically selling your ideas. You know, you're trying to sell yourself by selling your ideas, your opinions, and the more updated you are, the better structuring and the more, you know, interesting facts you come up with, the, you know, the better your score is going to be. And it's not my experience. We have learned this from the experience of the toppers from the previous years. And we have provided you, we have been providing you the interviews on our YouTube channel as well for the same. So guys, please Narveer, collect. Sure, sir.
Sir, there is a question, interesting question. Mm-hmm. How much time should be devoted to essay, pressy, letter, and RC, and how should we sequence it?
Right, sir. I'm coming to that, but just give me 1 second. Sure. Just finish this up. Yes. So, so keep on practicing your essays, guys. So at least 1 or 2 essays every week. Keep on, you know, start taking up new topics. Or we have also provided you a list of tentative essay topics. We do that every year. We provide it to our students, and you can take up the essay topics from there, and you can start writing on those particular topics. And along with that, along with essay topics, we also provide our students with the fodder material, so that, you know, they don't have to run pillar to post to fetch data. So they can collect data from the fodder material itself, and then they can draft in their head, and then they can practice typing. So that is the best part about our course. But still, at the same point of time, I would suggest that, guys, you start reading editorials and start writing essays at least twice or thrice a week. Every alternate day is a good frequency. Now, drafting pressy, many students find it very difficult. So how to draft a pressy? First of all, you must understand what's the difference between a summary and a pressy, guys. This is the biggest confusion that students have. They believe summary and pressy are one and the same thing, but they're actually not. They are poles apart. So you must understand what a pressy is and how to draft a pressy. When you read editorials every day, once a week or probably twice a week, whichever was your favorite, favorite article this week, take up that article, read it again, and then sit down and type your essay, type your pressy on your computer. So that would also help you with your, you know, improvement of your typing speed, as well as control of your structure of your answer. Now, obviously, you must know and practice application writing, report writing, or letter writing, right? Now, coming to the part, now, these are the 4 questions. And now I'm coming to the question, Avinash sir, that you asked, how much time should be allocated to each of these answers? Now, guys, you know that there are 90 minutes for this, right? The weightage for every question is what? 20, 20, 20, and this is 40. So guys, you very well understand which is the most scoring part. So start with your essay. So, you know, once you're done with the biggest chunk of your paper, then you would be mentally relieved, first of all, that, okay, I'm done with the articulation part. Now it is the comprehension part, where I have to read the passage and make a pressy, and then read the passage and draft my answers on the basis of that. So guys, about time breakage, I would say you should take about 25 to 27 minutes for your essay. That is my take. That is what I would do if I were to be appearing in this exam. The next, spend next 5 to 7 minutes reading your passage carefully. So 5 to 7 minutes to read your passage carefully. And as you go along, mark down the important key points of each and every paragraph and write them down in the rough piece of paper that would be given to you. If you're not given one, ask for one, right? So write down important points on the piece of paper that is next to you, so that later on when you refer to that piece of paper, you can draft your pressy and as well as you can actually relate to the particular paragraph that you want to look at, because it is going to be a big essay, guys. It is going to be 500, 600 words long passage. And the, from that passage, you'll have to make a 150 word pressy. So you must know which paragraphs were important while you are going through, because rereading the passage would lead to, you know, loss of time. So next 5 to 7 minutes for reading the passage, that comes down to 35 minutes. Then next 15 minutes for your pressy. Next 15 minutes should be devoted to your pressy. Drafting your pressy after you've read the passage, then next 15 minutes, I think, are more than enough to draft your pressy in your head as well as to type. So that gives us, that takes us to 50 minutes out of 90. Then you're left with 40 minutes. Then next 25 minutes should be allocated to RC answers, reading comprehension answers, because there are three questions and these three questions are worth 20 marks. And basically these are the most scoring part as well, because you have to read the passage, find out the data and then frame your answers, right? So which is not too difficult a task looking at the other questions, pressy making or essay writing. So 25 minutes for the next three questions, wherein you'll have to decide your word limit, because there are three questions for 20 marks. That means roughly one question is for 6 to 7 marks, right? So for 7 marks, you have to write at least 70 to 80 words. So to write three questions, that means 250 words, so that would take around 25 minutes. And then you are left with last 15 minutes. Then last 15 minutes should be allocated to your letter or report, whatever you are asked to write. But this is a general breakdown, guys, of the time. That's what I would take. But, you know, it actually depends on individual to individual. There would be students who would be good at framing their essays because they are already practicing for UPSC. Right? So they would be good at drafting their UPSC, you know, their essays because of the UPSC answer writing, but they may take longer in drafting a pressy or a letter or a report on, you know, for that matter. There would be some other students who would be working in organizations like RBI or SEBI or any other bank, and they would be, you know, they would be fluent in drafting their letter and pressy, but it would take longer time for them to draft an essay. So it actually depends on individual to individual, but that's a general breakdown of the word limit. The time limit or the time management part that you should undertake while you're drafting your, you know, your paper. And I also keep, you know, if you are good at typing, I also keep 5 minutes for buffer for your proofreading, guys. That is very, very important, because, you know, while you are typing, it's very common under pressure when you're typing your answers, you know, your mind is busy thinking of fancy vocabulary words. You want to present the best, and, you know, during that time you tend to make either a typo or a grammatical mistake here or there, or you may miss out a sentence or a word. And this is very common, because, you know, we are not into a habit of, you know, we may be into a habit of writing essays but not typing. So you have to get into that zone from now onwards and start writing your papers, guys. In this exam, it is all about your preparation. So preparation is basically what, you know, preparation. This is, you know, the word itself means you prepare beforehand. And the only smart way to prepare for this paper is to be ready, practice enough, and, you know, to make sure that you face different circumstances, different topics, different scenarios, so that whatever topic is thrown at you, you do not panic under pressure. So that would be my time management strategy for this. And now, guys, now look at this realistically. Now, these are the essay topics which were given in the previous years. And I specifically wanted to discuss these topics with you, considering your choice of topic. And, you know, you can now, I will show you how to categorize your topics. So starting from 2017, guys, in 2017, one topic was centralization of higher education. Now, guys, we can categorize this topic in under a static topic, right? Merger of SBI. This was under current affairs as well as your based on your finance, right? Digitization and ransomware, non-performing assets, nuclear power plant, positive and negative. Now, these were the topics for 2017. Now, for 2018, positive and negative effects of demonetization, measures for promoting microfinance in India, advantages of UPI, crowdfunding, the new phenomenon financing, financial literacy is needed for all age groups. Now, these were the topics that were given in the year 2018. In 2019, higher education, stress among youth, NPFC loan collection issues, democracy and importance of vote, and scope of 5G in India. Now, guys, looking at the essay topics, now what we can decipher is, now these essay topics are basically, they can be broken down into three different verticals. One is static. Second is anything based on ARD and ESI, right? And third is anything based on your current affairs as well as your economics. So based on your economy. So once you understand that these are three different verticals of your topics of your essays, now you can start, you know, imagining and preparing in your head that, okay, if I want to write about higher education, what information I have to, you know, use to draft my essay right there and right then. Now, stress among youth, it's a very static topic, but what are you going to write about? How are you going to stand out from the crowd? You know, you have to be the top one percentile or one percentage of the candidates. So how to reach there? That is the strategy, guys. You have to be prepared. You have to be sure. Okay, if I'm not prepared for static topics, let me be prepared for topics which are based on, you know, economy or current affairs. For example, NPFC loan collection issues. Now, this is a very, this was a very burning topic at that point of time and everybody read about it. But if you were smart enough, you would be prepared with your facts, with your data, with your reports, with your statistics to be mentioned and highlighted in your essay. So this is the way you can score, you know, well in this exam, to prepare and to practice enough beforehand. So these were the essay topics that were thrown at the aspirants in the previous years. And coming to the sources, I've taken a lot of your time, guys. So I would try to wrap it up as soon as possible. Obviously, go for newspapers, the Economic Times, a very good source, the Hindu, I mean, there is nothing better than that. The Hindu is actually the, you know, the one that you start your challenges with in the morning. So the Hindu or the Economic Times. Now for online articles, I would say anything related to economic and current issues, that is Live Mint or PIB, as most of my colleagues told you. For ARD and ESI books and material, now why I mentioned this here, because from this, guys, you must remember reports from particular, you know, particular agencies. You must remember schemes launched by the government. Now, guys, there is always a structure that we have always elaborated on, that you should start with your body, then how to draft your, you know, you should start with a good introduction, then how to draft your body, what, why, where, when. So using the seven W's, but now we have, you know, stumbled upon a better approach to writing your essays. So guys, understand this. If you use facts, data, statistics, and schemes and reports, your essay will obviously look informative. It would stand out. The person who's evaluating will definitely understand that the student is not just prepared for one subject. He is, you know, he is well informed. He is, you know, he's up to date. He's well informed. He's well read. He's well prepared, and he's given everything to this preparation. That is how you get selected, guys. That's what I feel. So this was my take on the descriptive English part. And now, guys, I am open to your questions. Ma'am, please ask. Let me know if there were any questions for that. And Avinash sir, Veena ma'am, VD sir, please, if you have any inputs, please, you are, please feel free to help me out here.
Narveer sir, I would just like take this. I would like to take this opportunity because you have mentioned about English part, right, and the importance of PSI and ARD. So on that note, I would like to show the cutoffs of phase two and then interview also to the students so that they can understand that what is actually required by them, right? I'll just quickly show them. I apologize to the students and my dear faculty members. I was just pushed out of the meeting due to technical error. Yes,
Hanji sir. Yeah, I would like to answer one more query which I could see from many of the students, sir. Would the faculty be able to evaluate our essays? Now, guys, I would love to do so, but the, you know, it's a limitation that, you know, after so many hours of work and everything that we are doing for you, I mean, I have very little time left for evaluation. I can evaluate a few, but I cannot evaluate all of you. So for that, I have good news for everyone. Very soon we will be coming out with a special batch for only evaluation. So that batch would be separate from from the combo course or the gold or the silver course that you have purchased. It would be a course wherein we will be providing you all the videos for your preparation. We would be providing you fodder material for your preparation. We would be providing you essay topics. But the most important part is we would be giving you 2 full-length mock tests, and we would be evaluating those mock tests for you. And then we would be calling each and every one of you to discuss your attempt. And then we would also be telling you over the call how to improve, what you should have done, what you should not have done in the exam. So guys, don't worry, very soon we will come out with a special batch for evaluation of your essays and for your whole mock tests. So that is the answer for the queries for those who were asking about evaluation. Any other query you want me to address, ma'am?
Sir, as of now, I don't think any other query you have taken. I think almost all the queries, but still if we get any other, I'll just pick that up.
Somebody just asked that is the passage for Prezi and RC the same? Yes, usually in the past years, the passage for RC and Prezi are same, but it's quite a long passage, right? It's a quite a long passage, somewhere around 600, 700 words, which is quite difficult to comprehend at the same time. So it would not be a story about Mahabharata or Ramayana. Please be aware of that. The topic would be related to somehow either on your current affairs or probably related to your agrarian economy or, you know, your social issues or anything like that. So it would be a good passage of good level, and you'll have to comprehend everything, read between the lines, and then on the same passage you would have to draft a Prezi, and on the same passage you would have to write your reading comprehension answers. Now many students ask me, sir, what is the point of making a Prezi and writing RC answers on the same passage? Now guys, this is what they are evaluating. They want to evaluate on one hand that are you able to, you know, summarize or make a Prezi out of the whole passage in your own words. So that is a very different thing where you have to eliminate any superfluous data, any information that you feel that is not required, and only keep the central theme, the crux of the passage, and make a Prezi out of it. On the other hand, they would ask you to write elaborative reading comprehension answers. Now there, they want to see if a student can find information from the passage and elaborate in his own words. So the passage would be same, but the drafting would be different. Right,
sir. So let me just take students to the cutoff thing so that they can understand what you have been telling, what we have all been telling.
Absolutely, ma'am. Thank you so much, ma'am.
So yes, see guys, this is the cutoff in front of you. Paper 1 plus paper 2 cutoff, that means 200 marks, English descriptive and your ESI-ARD. Paper 2020, in the year 2020, you see 126. Previous year it was 127.5. 2018, 124. Now this tells you that your cutoff has remained. The paper changed, the pattern changed, current affairs is coming, weightage of static is changing, but the weightage, the cutoff you see is in the line of 120s, right? The figures are this one. So out of 200, this means you need to score. This is a decent score. You get selected if you cross this cutoff. Here, I would like also to mention one very important point. I think Naveer sir would agree with me on this. It is possible to score 70 or 70 plus in English descriptive paper, right? And if you see, we are going to come up with another session where we will be discussing with you the marks of the toppers, right? So the toppers marks of ARD ESI paper, 100 mark paper of phase 2, they have got in the range of 50-52. So that means if you are able to manage 50 to 55 marks in ARD ESI combined, out of which I would say 30 marks or 35 marks would be from current affairs itself, right? You can clear the cutoff. So this is about the strength part. This is about, you know, what happens is that students are always in this fear that ARD, ESI, I am from not agri background, or ESI is so lengthy, current affairs, so much to cover, but they do not give due importance to English descriptor. Here, you have to understand, if you do that bit of extra practice, you follow what things have been told to you, you can take your marks up in English descriptive, thereby balancing your ESI ARD. You have to understand this, that you do not need to score full marks here. You need to clear cut off. And strategy is here in front of you, right? So this is about paper one and paper two. Also see, please, phase two plus interview marks. Interviews of 25 marks. So you see, if we out of 225, the cutoff again has been in the range of 150s. So out of 225, the story begins from your current affairs, I would say. Prepare current affairs well, score good in ESI ARD with a good knowledge, of course, of static. You cannot ignore that part. Use that in your English. Do good practice of English descriptive. And yes, you are here, right? So that is about cutoff, guys. And I think I was sharing this slide with you. It was almost done. I think you can note down these things. We have discussed what all to cover, what are the topics. So these are the sources also, right? All the things, you can directly go to the websites, PDFs are there. Now the question is that things are lengthy. You know, the original reports, I was seeing this question also, that original reports, if we see, are quite lengthy. What to do? So guys, I would give you a simple strategy for that. Know your previous year questions. If you know what you need to extract out, what is asked in the examination, what type of questions are asked, which figures are relevant for you, if they have said that rural areas would be given, rural development would be given focus. So are the questions in SCCC census more on rural-based figures? Yes. So have that knowledge of previous year questions. Then you can easily extract out that lengthy information can be summarized into small pointers that will be helpful to you. So understanding of the syllabus and of course your previous year questions will be guiding you through the requirements of the examination. And of course, if you have the course, then everything is covered in a crisp manner. You just have to go through that, practice quiz, take mock tests and everything, right? So I think that would be it from our end. Now, sir, Veena ma'am is also here now. So we will quickly take up the queries if there are any, right, before we wind up.
Right, ma'am. Somebody asked me, I think, let me just refer to the question. So there was a student who asked me, sir, if you are asked to write about this topic, benefits or advantages of UPI. So would you be only writing about the benefits of UPI or should we also counter the topic and write negative effects? So I would like to answer that. Obviously, if they've specifically mentioned that, write down the advantages of UPI. So yes, I mean, mostly you would be highlighting the advantages only, but yes, if there is some downside to that particular topic, you can add it up with the particular point. For example, let's say if you're writing that it's easy to use, but you know, at the same point of time, there is an issue of security, right? So you don't have to actually push into it the negative impacts of something, but you have to highlight that is the way you are going to express your insight into that particular subject or that particular topic. But yet don't go on writing pros and cons. That makes it very monotonous. So guys, that is what we try to help you to not to follow the same structure of essays what you have been doing all your life. You know, we have written essays since we were kids. Right, ma'am? We started with my country or my best friend, if I remember, right? Or my cow. I remember we started writing essays, right? My cow or my favorite, my animal or my country. But, you know, we have to, change our way of presentation now. We have to be crisp at the same point of time. We have to be, politically correct at the same point of time, right? So, you cannot just keep on bragging about one point or one aspect of a topic. You have to write organically and generically about any topic that you choose to write upon. So that was my answer to that. Somebody, Sushmita, was asking me, sir, what is the format of letter and report? Yes, Sushmita, there are videos on our YouTube channel that I have clearly explained the format of a report and a letter in those YouTube sessions as well. And if you are a student, then in the course as well, we have provided you videos for the same. So it's a 10-step process for letter, the structure of a letter, the format of a letter for formal and informal both. So it would be easy to explain it to you in the specific videos. Now, in this session, it would be difficult for me to explain the 10-step format for you. So please, bear with me, and I apologize for that. But yes, in some other session, I would definitely take it up for you. So how do we cover schemes and state schemes? If it is relevant, anonymous attendee, but schemes, the major schemes, and specifically which have been launched in the last 5 years. If I can remember out of the blue, I think Ayushman Yojana, Jal Shakti Ministry, Kisan Vikas Yojana, Kisan Credit Card Yojana, I think, right, KCC. And then there are many. I would not start saying about this because Ritika ma'am is here, Veena ma'am is here, Avinash sir, they're all here. So they would be, frowning upon me. No, but I do understand schemes are very important. And this is the knowledge that every educated individual must have. That's what I feel, guys. You know, even if you're living in a country, you must know what Kisan Credit Card is, right? What APMCs are, what these farm laws are, right? So if you actually want to prove yourself, then prove it to yourself first. You know, be at that level, be at this preparation stage, that even if you are asked to write about any random topic, you have n number of facts, data, statistics, so that you can support your notion and support your ideas and put it not very assertively, but in a logical manner at the same point of time.
I would just tell students about the course. There are queries regarding our course, the offerings, the description. So guys, sure. We have a gold course that includes phase one and phase two complete preparation. When we say complete, that means starting from phase one to phase two. And of course, in mock interviews also, gold course is there, and then silver course for phase two, right? For any other query, like what are the complete features, what are the price. So please drop us a mail at hello@edutab.co.in. I can see some other queries are also there about other examinations like EPFO or other. So guys, that also we will not be able to cater to in this particular session. Probably we will come up with a webinar on that particular exam right in coming days. Now we will restrict ourselves to NABARD Pre-Day. We hope that all your queries have been answered, but if anything has been left, guys, please feel free to drop a mail at hello@edutab.co.in, right? You can also note down our number 8146207241. Give us a call. And yes, before going, I would just like to tell you, faculty members, do you remember about a surprise? So students, yes, thank you for being here, for joining the session till the end, and do check your mails, okay? By tomorrow, within 24 hours, you'll get a surprise from EduTab on your mail, right? So thank you so much. And I think that would be it. Members from RN. Okay, guys. Thank you so much for joining. Bye-bye. Take care.
We'll end the meeting, ma'am.
Yes. Do you have the control?
No, I don't.